myself. My name is Adam Gaudette. I'm your town manager. I've been here for 7 years, so I'm just starting my 8th year. I've been town manager for about 15 years and 25 overall working in community development and planning. Just want to welcome you to our fire station, first of all. So those of you that have never been here before, it's something that you all should be proud of and the town should be proud of. And I know that we're very happy. The people that work out of here are extremely happy. Look at a couple more people. So just a couple of housekeeping things. There's restrooms across the hall. And then in the case of emergency, we can fly out this door or fly out that door or fly out that door. Should be pretty safe in here. Modern sprinkling system and the fire truck. A couple of but other than that, I expect everything to go okay. We are being recorded. It's not live, but they're going to tape it just like they do town meeting and then load it up on YouTube, Facebook, and all the other things. We do have a lot of information. I know we've had some calls from people, but if you go to our website, www.northbridgemass.org, right on the front page is a projects. So just click right on that. And there's a lot of the backup information that's in here. And in addition to that, I'll load this up tomorrow. I was working on it today, so it's not up there. So I'll share it with people. My job as town manager is to get you the right information or the information that you need to make a decision. You know, this is certainly an issue. It's we've been working on for a few years, and I'll get into that. And this is all in advance of preparation for a town meeting next week and then the ballot in a couple of weeks. I'll explain a couple of things, and that's why there's no dollar amount on the warrant, and then there's no dollar amount on the ballot. And I'll get to that at the end. Again, welcome everyone. I introduce myself. This is Jamie Lukin to my immediate right. He's the Department of Public Works Director. He's been the director for a couple of years, but he's been with us for 10 or 12. So he's here, and he's going to help answer any questions that you may have relative to the building itself as it currently sits, as he's been in charge of maintaining that for the last years, ever since the school department graciously gave it back to us. To his right is Mr. Joe Sullivan. He is with CHA Solutions. Joe was the owner's project manager representing the town on this building here. So we have a lot to thank. I know the chief. Chief and Joe work real close on a lot of things within this building, and he's also the owner's project manager on the Town Hall Annex project. If anyone has any questions on that, I can do that at the very end. We'll pull me to the side. To his right is Jonathan Charwick. He works for Activitas. Activitas was the designer and the owner's project manager for LaSalle Field, the turf field, and also recently for the Linwood Playgrounds basketball court project. So. Those guys are very familiar with the town. Joe will answer any questions that we have specific to the demo. And then John, he can answer any questions specifically you have on the park. what I'm going to do is kind of break this up into certain segments. I'll get into a little bit of the background and how we got to this point here today. We're going to then move on to the actual demo part of the project, and then we're going to stop and take a break there, and then answer questions specifically to demo. And then we'll get into the park project, why are we doing that, different aspects of that, and then we'll take another break, and then we'll go to the taxpayer impacts, and we'll take another break. So if you have a question regarding the timeline of these things, just kind of wait to that part of it, so we're not going all over the place. But feel free to ask questions, I talk fast, and if you do, just raise your hand. If you want me to clarify something, happy to do that, but keep in mind that I might push you off to a slide that's 3 or 4 slides down the road. Everyone see okay, first of all? So how did we get here? So in the fall of 2017, the Ballmer School Building Committee, which was created as part of the MSBA project, invitation into the program, if you will. MSBA stands for the Massachusetts School Building Authority. So the town voters, I think it was back in 2015, agreed to enter into the program. We applied for a letter of interest. We were awarded feasibility money, the town matched those funds at town meeting, created the building committee, and then they started studying what to do with Ballmer. As part of that process, they also began to look at NES. And after a thorough look at NES, at that time, the building committee in the fall of 2017, just a couple months after I started here, we voted to include NES in the total project for the new Ballmer. And why did we do that? We did that because school, the NES, was built in 1952, the old section. 83, there was renovations with the newer section. They had been in modulars, that was on the grass strip that was rented from St. Pat's. So let's go back. So right to the right of the, this doesn't work, but to the right of where that parking strip is on the right. That's, there were, there you go. Anyway, that's where the modulars were. They've since been torn down. We're out of our lease, obviously, because now the Ballmer School is in play. The NES building itself has many, many architectural and MEP deficiencies. MEP is mechanicals, boilers, heating systems, all original. Many code issues, no sprinklers, a lot of ADA absences. It's undersized. At the time, the value of the estimated repairs for NES was $20 million back in 2017. I know there's a couple people on the committee here. But back then it was $20 million. So as you know, since COVID, cost of construction has gone way up, cost of labor, cost of supplies, all that stuff. That led us to asking for more funds here because we asked for original money before COVID. But since COVID, those costs. So the cost of repair NES now today is probably closer to $30 million than it is to $20 million. At that time, MSBA would not contribute any money to the repairs of NES. So if we were going to improve NES and upgrade NES, that would all be on the town residents at the time. Why do we, again, continue to do NES? Because of in the total Ballmer project? Because MSBA was going to pony up almost 50% of the total cost of doing the two buildings. So basically, we were getting, I don't say free money, but money that made more sense to put into a brand new building than to renovate NES. This is long history, so I apologize if I'm hashing old hash. We got good low interest rates at the time we knew when we were borrowing. We got 2.79% on the first $30 million we borrowed. In the fall of 2018, the town approved that total project. That was a rendering of it, the site plan of it, and then it was completed in the fall of 2021. Continuing on with background of NES, the custody of NES was transferred to the Board of Selectmen by a town meeting vote in May of 2021. So again, students were moving in the fall of 2021. We got through COVID. We knew when it was going to be complete enough for people to move in. Project wasn't completely closed out then. But we voted to, the town board voted to turn that property over to the Board of Selectmen as the school committee had no longer any use for it. In May of 21, that same town meeting, the voters approved $100,000 that I suggested to you all to approve to conduct a feasibility on what we should do with NES reuse and redevelopment. In the fall of 2021, after putting together RFP over the summer, coordinating all that, the building planning construction committee, there's a couple of people here, they oversaw this building as well. They advertised an RFP to hire someone to do the feasibility study for what should we do with NES. We kept on doing other things along simultaneously while the architect Abacus was hired in the winter of 21-22. While they began to do their study, we did a full existing conditions survey plan on the site. We did a phase one environmental study, which is a lot of research, more paperwork and windows analysis, for lack of a better term. And then in the winter of 2023, Abacus had community meetings. They had focus groups. They had interviews with people from town, realtors, chamber people, other people. In the spring of 23, we kept going, and we performed a phase two environmental study on the property. So there was identification of underground oil tank outside, but we dug that up and put monitoring wells in and found that there was no contamination. But that study is also online. So the existing condition survey is online. The phase one and the phase two are both online as well. Spring of 23, Abacus completes the reuse study. That's online as well. You can look at that full document. They completed the study in the spring of 23, and then that May, the town meeting, the Board of Selectmen brought an article to town meeting saying, you know, we've gone through this whole process, we've figured out like what the market is, what can we do, blah, blah, blah. And in order to sell town property, because the voters of Northbridge own all the property in town, the Board of Selectmen asked them if they would get permission to sell the building. That article failed. And some of you may have been there, and some of you know why. There may be other specific reasons, but I basically put up here that the town meeting sentiment at that time was that they would rather, the voters would rather advertise, because it was an important piece of property, advertise the RFP first, see what we get for proposals, and then have the selectmen bring back a proposal for a future town meeting. And that's what we did. As far as the actual study itself, it included some additional site and building assessments, even though we had done some already previously with the Ballmer School project. There was a market study, and I'll get to that in a second. Building reutilization options, what could you do if you did selective demolition, kept some of it, got rid of it all, blah, blah, blah. Site reutilization options, we looked at getting rid of the school administration building, which is, apologize if I didn't say that before, but this is the, obviously, the school administration building and their parking. Some of the plans had included developing on that site at the end of the day. Through the community feedback that we got, we decided not to touch that site with a lot of the plans that were produced. But you can see the different types of development that were proposed. Again, these were just options that could be done. This is a low density housing development, 14 duplexes. This is a medium density, if you will, for 29 townhomes. And then this one was 48 to 72 apartment units, 48 to 72, but depending on whether or not you went two or three floors. This was a commercial use. There was discussion about, hey, it'd be a great site for a restaurant or a brewery. And then there was also a conversation about, hey, it'd be a great site for a community center. So all those options are in the feasibility study if you go online and look at it. The market study. Very important piece of this whole feasibility study in terms of what will likely come out of this once we advertise was the market study. So this gentleman named Drew Leff of Stantec, who is an economic development specialist, consultant, if you will, performed a market analysis, all kinds of data, that's in the study. In his report, in his final conclusions, I read in the yellow, these investigations concluded that there is a strong demand for housing in the region and immediate area, and that this site would be most appropriate for multifamily housing development. That's not saying he chooses that, like, most appropriate. It meant that's what the market is. And we all are familiar with the economy in Massachusetts, New England, across the states. Housing is a very important issue here in New England. Then he had some renderings, or not renderings, pictures of different types of housing developments based on the density that I showed you before, duplexes, townhomes, and apartments. So what happens? So we complete the study, we go to town meeting. Town meeting says we want you to advertise, so we advertise. We advertise in the fall of 23. We had to put together an RFP over the summer. We advertised. It goes to the paper for 30 days. And then eventually bids were, or sorry, 60 days, and then eventually bids were received. I say bids, it's actually proposals. It's not a bid in terms of a dollar amount. It's more about what the use is gonna be. But we advertised for 60 days, and we got one response. And that response, as everybody knows, was multifamily housing. There was no bids for office, there was no bids for restaurants, et cetera, et cetera. As most people know, people who work in Boston, office space is going away, people are working at home, there's no interest in that. The interest is housing. And that's what the market is. And that's what I say, is like, you don't know what the market is. You can say what the market is and you study, but until you actually advertise and you see what the market is. Same thing when you list your house for sale in terms of what pricing you get. What's the market? The market is for one housing development. It was a local developer, local builder out of Milford, does these types of projects. He originally proposed 10 townhomes on this section of land here. And then he had, I think, 36 units in the apartment building. He then held a community meeting. A couple things. Actually, I want to go back to a couple things that were brought up to me that were put out there. One of the things was a concern about us advertising over the holidays. Just want to say that, you know, most of us work year round. Even though it's the holidays, we, you know, this is not an abnormal time to advertise. I'll get into a second because we advertise a second time. And then the other thing is that after the meeting with folks, the developer revised the study down to 138 unit building, got rid of the 10 townhomes and created 17,000 square feet of parking space. One of the things that I heard was, why were not the Board of Selectmen at that meeting? Well, the Board of Selectmen had many other meetings related to this project. We specifically didn't go to that meeting because, and I know some other board members did, Finance Committee and others, specifically the Selectmen and I did not go to that meeting because we wanted it to be completely one-on-one, as close as could be, the residents or the abutters, asking questions to the developer. Okay? In his proposal, it included the developer paying for the demo. And that's why he had so many units, 38 units. People say, well, why don't you just do three homes? Well, you can't tear down a building for a couple $1 million and then expect your rate of return without some kind of density. And that's why he had the density that he did. We brought this proposal, a couple other things. It was apartments, single, double, three bedroom units, proposed 10% affordable. There is laws out there, it's under chapter 40B that talks about affordability of towns in terms of their housing. Every town is required to target 10% of their housing townwide to be affordable. That includes many different types of housing, housing authority, mobile homes, Section 8, so on and so on. But when you do a project like this and you apply for a certain application, when you apply and they reserve 10% of the units in this 30-unit project as affordable, the whole project would qualify. And that would bring our percentage up. Currently right now we're around 7%. So what that means is we're subject to certain applications that people can actually bypass the zoning. They're called 40B developments. Someone could come in and a 1 acre piece of parcel, apply for a 40B, and it says, you know, you can only do 4 units, and they can do 16. Or they could do 100 acres and say, single families, you could say, you could do 30. They could come in and they could do 130. So that's one of the things that is positive for a town when you look at doing these types of projects or partnering up with a developer, is that you are providing housing for people that need it, and the second, people that can afford what you're providing. Went to town meeting in May of 24, this past May. Town meeting voters rejected the article to sell, and thus this specific project was rejected. The sentiment at the time, again, there's many other issues, but just from what I remember in general, there was a sentiment that the property was too dense for the neighborhood, too much traffic would be generated or added to the neighborhood, and that there was only one proposal to choose from. As far as only one proposal, that is what we got. You know, there are certain requirements under Chapter 30B when you sell a town property in terms of requirements for advertising. One of them is you put it on your website. Another one is you put it in the local newspaper for at least 2 weeks. Another one is you put it in the Central Register. Central Register, I call it a national publication that the state puts out. It puts out these publications for towns that advertise the property, advertise the contracts, advertising to buy a fire truck, all these types of things. So we only got one response out of that. That's not our fault. We can only put it out there and ask. We are not allowed to put a for sale sign up on the side of the property, Joe's Realty, and say, you know, have Joe sell it. That's not allowed. We have to advertise in certain publications. It has to be an open, fair, and competitive process. That's why they do it. The reason we do an RFP or request for proposals is because it allows the town, whoever's looking at the proposal that's been submitted, and that it's not necessarily the highest price. It could be the highest price and a very bad idea, so you don't want that. So Chapter 30B gives you the flexibility to choose the best idea. In this case, there was only one idea. Again, a developer from Milford, selectman thought it was worthy enough to build, bring it to town meeting. They didn't fail. So after town meeting fails, and we have to wait until the next town meeting, which is next week, and the next ballot, which is 2 weeks after that. In the meantime, you know, what are we going to do? Well, one of the criticisms was we only got one proposal, and we advertised it over Christmas. So guess what? We advertised it again. We advertised it from May to July, 60 days, and we got no bids. I had one visit from a previous developer asking me about, you know, what I thought and everything else and what they did, and they just said they weren't going to waste their time in it if the town didn't want that type of project. But they needed to have that many units in order to pay for the demo. In addition to that, I had one call from a developer from Michigan looking to build multifamily housing. They asked me what happened in May. I explained to them, and they said they're not going to fly out here and waste their time because they were looking at doing even more units than what we were proposing. Because that's what's going on around the country. No responses to the second RFP. We did it again. Same publications. We did it over the summer, late spring. Perfect time to advertise. No bids. So therefore, the Board of Selectmen voted to place Articles 3 and Article 4 on the fall annual town meeting warrant. That's next week. 2 weeks after that, there's questions 6 and 7. There's 5 state questions that you're going to be asked if you go vote. And Articles 6 and 7 are specific to the town, and those are relative to the demo and the park. One thing I want to explain is why there's two articles and why there's two sets of approvals. Town meeting we have to go to town meeting to get, in this case, we're not looking for permission to sell, what we're looking for permission to do is to borrow money. So anytime you got looking to borrow money, you gotta go to town meeting. So the two articles on town meeting, they're separate, just in case one passes and one doesn't. The demo is, again, asking permission to borrow, it's the specifics of how much and blah, 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 and then same thing with the park. The second set of approvals at the ballot, that's required because in order to pay the debt for this borrowing, the Board of Selectmen has decided that the only way to do it is to override, lack of a better term, Proposition 2.5, and increase the tax levy for the specific payment of that debt. So it's not an override, he's saying it's forever. You hear the old word, like, oh my God, Town Grafton did $4.6 million for the schools and Shrewsbury did $8 million, and that's forever? Yeah, that's forever. Debt exclusion is an override of 2.5 only for the debt. It's called debt exclusion. So both articles, they're partnered up, if you will. If one passes and the other doesn't, it's dead. If the town meeting articles approve it, you go to the ballot, well, it's not the Board of Selectmen, like, I borrow that money and then try to fit that in the operating budget. We just don't have enough, and we're not Wellesley, we don't have that much room to do that. So that's why there's two sets of articles of approvals. In addition to that, if you look at the town meeting warrant, which is also on our website, there's no dollar amount in there. That's because the warrant article has to be advertised and closed by a certain date. I think it's 5 Fridays before town meeting. And then at that point, it can change after that. So sometimes we put an article in and dollar amounts change and things change. How are you gonna do it, blah, blah, blah. And then the motion at town meeting will include a specific number. And those are the numbers we're gonna go over with you tonight as well. As far as the ballot questions do not include a number at all either. And that's state law. That's not, the town doesn't say, hey, we're blindly trying to slip $8 million under the rug here. The state law says specifically, this is the language of the article. You write the name, change the little parentheses, you change the town, and then you change the project. That's it. That's the ballot question. So when you go to the ballot on November 5th, you're not gonna see a dollar amount. Okay, that's why. So why are we demoing a building? Well, obviously, it's $20 to $30 million repair, somewhere in there, to repair it, and we no longer have a need for it. The school doesn't need it. The building itself, we're not gonna put $20 or $30 million into a building that we really don't have a need for. We have a new fire station, we have new schools, town hall's doing fine, annex, we relocated them here, so if you go on the far side, and if you came in, all the people that were in the town hall annex, planning, conservation, board of health, all those people, they're in a brand new wing down the hall here. So there's no longer a need for us that would justify us putting $20 or $30 million into an obsolete building. Why are, in addition, are we demoing it? Because the voters rejected the only proposal that we happened when we got, and we also got no new proposals. So we don't have a need, and we don't have anyone proposing to do anything with the existing building or the existing property as it sits today. In addition to that, I've used this number at town meeting other times of this $100,000 that the town is using annually to take care of this building. So here's half of it, called $48,000. This is our contract for vacant building insurance. Vacant building insurance is very, very costly. It's a liability. Our main insurance company wouldn't do it. They didn't do it last year. Last year, I think we had Hartford, or Hanover. Maybe it was Hanover. And then this year, it went up $6,000 in 1 year just to insure a vacant building. In addition to that number, that 48, the whole property insurance for the whole town, $100 million school, $23 million fire station, town hall, the sewer plant, all the insurance that we pay in town is $210,000. So about 20% above that, $40,000 is tied up in that one building. That's, you know, almost a police officer's salary right there. In addition, we're spending utility costs. In FY21, talking to the school department, they were spending up to $75,000 in utilities, building maintenance, not building maintenance in terms of custodial, like trash cans, whatever. We got that down to about 50 to 55. So we keep the heat on 40, just for the purposes of keeping the building in its integrity in some way. We have gas, electric, water, and we spend money on repairs. We also, in addition to doing that, and why we're doing that, is because we rent out several classrooms to the Toys for Tots program. So everybody knows Bill Audette from town. He was a former officer in town. He's a former selectman. He runs the Toys for Tots program. He approached us a couple years ago. We got this building. Hey, we need space to put the Toys for Tots. Perfect. We don't charge them any rent. They're in there. So that's one of the reasons why we have some heat, some electricity, some water bills, right? So that's your how you get to 100,000. I had that 48,000, and we haven't got this year yet, but last 2 years it was 1555. Vacant building is a liability. You see the vandalism that we've been suffering since we've owned the building. We have security cameras. We have caught people. Doesn't stop people, so or kids or anyone else. But this is some of the pictures of the broken windows, classrooms, people breaking in. Then the DPW goes out there and puts up wood. We've had police going in there doing searches. Everyone remembers there was a stabbing on the common. There was also a stabbing out in front of NES. And we had to do searches of the building. Obviously, if the building's not there, that's obviously less dangerous than having to do searches in buildings with people with weapons. Pulled fire alarm, suspicious activity, blah, blah, blah. And there's a cost benefit. There's a cost benefit that we're spending municipal resources, police, fire, DPW, anyone else, dispatch, handling a vacant building that could be going to somewhere else. So these are all the reasons why we're looking to demo. We don't have another option. It's an eyesore. It's a liability. It's costing us money, et cetera, et cetera. Demolition costs and how we got to this number. So the number that we're looking to ask at town meeting is going to be this $2.5 million. How do we get to that point? I asked three contractors, Fontaine Brothers, they're the ones who built the Balmer School. Remember that name. CHA, is that guy right there? Joe Sullivan, who's an owner's project manager, who has overseen projects that, for schools and other that include demolition. And then American Environmental, which is a contractor out of Holyoke that does this type of work. So I called them and asked for estimates. There's two major pieces to this. It's abatement of asbestos and other hazardous materials, and then obviously to demolish the structure. Because we don't have a study at this time, the estimates, and depending on cost, market, et cetera, 800,000 to 1.3 just to do abatement. The demolition, get rid of the buildings, is just a general picture, anywhere from 700 to a million and change. And then we have soft costs. You have to hire someone who specializes in putting the specifications together so that it's done right. You have to hire someone to monitor a third-party person like an OPM so they make sure the contractor's doing everything they're supposed to be doing in accordance with state law when you're getting rid of hazardous materials. We have contingency. That being said, we're estimating about $150,000. So if the maximum cost came to fruition, 1.3, 1.05, and 150 is 2.5. Something to note, if we advertise this project, it gets approved, we advertise it, and we do it, and let's say we only spend 1.7. That doesn't allow a town to take 800 grand and then go buy whatever we want with it. We can only do the 1.7, and we're only going to borrow the 1.7. I'm going to show you some taxpayer impacts, and it's on the full 2.5, but we're hoping that it's lower than higher. But that's why we're asking for 2.5. So I'm going to stop right here, because I talk a lot, and I'm going to ask, does anyone have any specific questions in terms of how we got here or about the demo? I know everyone has got opinions too about whether or not we should be doing this, whether we should not. And you know, this is a forum. If you want to do that, you can do that. But I want to take advantage of the people that are here to answer questions. Town meeting is a great place to say I don't want it, this is why. But if any specific questions in terms of how we got here or regarding the process of demo costs, sir?
Just a question on the
just
demo.
Your name for the record.
Sorry, my name is Chris Henderson.
Yep.
Just a question on the demo costs.
Yep.
Is that a not to exceed number, that 2.5, or is there a chance that that number could go higher?
So if we get that number approved at town meeting, it comes in at 2.7, we have to back out. We can't go any higher unless I go back to town meeting and ask for more money. So it's a not to exceed. Yeah, and that's why we're asking for the higher number. The hard part about this, and people a lot of times say, well, why don't you advertise first, blah, blah, blah. You know, bids are only good for so long. People aren't going to bid if you don't have the money, blah, 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 whatever. So you're more likely to get bids if you have a budget and you have money in a bank account set aside.
So you're looking for firm fixed bids?
So we will be advertising. So I have a timeline at the very end, but I'll talk about how, if it is approved, what the next steps are, and that includes hiring an OPM. That includes putting together the specifications and studying the abatement. That includes advertising. The construction for this, because it's a town building, requires prevailing wage, requires obviously all the courts with all the other state laws regarding abatement, and will require a public bid advertisement, just as I talked about when we did when we looked to sell the building. We have to advertise in the Central Register. In that case, there's two requirements for bidders. They have to be a responsible bidder, I mean they're not on a list, a banned list by DCAM or other, and they have to be responsible. And then the other requirement is the amount. So if we get three bids and it's 2.1, 2.2, and 2.3, we take the 2.1. In the back.
Richard Scully of Newland Road. There is a savings. If the building gets torn down, there will be a savings of $48,000 a year roughly on insurance, $55,000 for DPW, $75,000 for the school department.
Well, $75,000 is not, the school's not paying for that anymore. We took that on. So call it $100,000.
Okay, $100,000. Does that $100,000 now in turn go towards repaying the loan?
No, that $100,000 was money we did not have before. So either A, we've had to hold back hiring a position, or B, advancing a different department because we had to come up with $100,000 in cost. I can tell you right now, the general government towns, we get about $1 million a year. I think it was 1.1 this past year. So $55 million budget, based on our revenue, we get 2%, called 1.1. So we then have to pay for health insurance, we have to pay for BVT, we pay for our liability insurance, pay for all of our fixed costs first, and then whatever's left, the school and the town splits. The school gets about $500,000, and the town of Northbridge government, general government, police, fire, DPW, all that, gets about $150,000, let's say. So when that $100,000 comes up, and it's new costs, it comes out of the fixed costs, the $50,000 added, and then, so the pile gets smaller for what's left for the school and the town, and then guess who has to eat up the other 50 for the maintenance and the budget? Not the school, that came out of us. So technically, instead of having $150,000 available to spend that 1 year, or the last couple of years, we've had less. So I would like to do other things. I have department heads that come to the finance committee meeting every year. I encourage you to come, because all meetings are public. And ask for more officers. I ask for full-time position, additional library help. DPW, this guy, and Barry stands up for Jamie at every finance committee meeting. Give this guy more people. We took on a cemetery of so many acres and we didn't hire any more people and we had to eat in our budget. Those are the types of things I would like to address with that money, because it's holding us back. Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Marlene DeVries through St. James Court. Is there a way that town residents can see what's going on in the Central Register? Is there a way we can look
it's
at
a
that?
Public, well, if you go to the website, if you go to mass.gov, I believe it's under Inspector General or Secretary of State?
Inspector General.
So if you go into the, you can do a Google search and find it, but if you go to mass.gov, top right hand corner, it'll say search, and you type in Central Register, it's under the Inspector General's office. It's a publication that comes out every Wednesday. So if we're gonna put anything in, we have to have it to them by Thursday, and then we fill out a form, what town, what project, what budget, blah, 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 and then every Wednesday it's in there. And then
following Wednesday,
yes. So what's in there, you'll see it's classified under different types of projects. One is like supplies, paper, fire trucks, blah, blah, blah. And then another is planning projects, construction projects, et cetera. So you go in there and all 351 towns in Massachusetts use it.
What would we be looking for under all those different?
So what we would do is if this project was approved, we would advertise in the Central Register, town of Northbridge is looking for demolition, and we carry a budget number for that.
So it would be under projects?
Yep. Construction, I think.
Charlie Wattler, in the $2.5 million estimate, what's included to leave the site after the demo? Is it, what's in that scope?
So
let it look like what it's all
about. Yeah, what does the site generally look like after a demo?
So typically, the part of the specification requirements require, all of the debris to be separated, recycled as much as they can after the abatement is completed. There's a transcript that's going to be needed for a bill of lading to determine where that material is going to go, because the town would be on the hook. If we don't clean it before it goes, the town would be on the hook for the cleanup going forward. So once all of that is removed, they'll take the foundations out of place. Typically, they'll backfill it and level it to a level site. And usually, I like to see a as-built of the site done, so it gives us a baseline of what the property is, so that if we ever go to do a project moving forward, you have a baseline to be able to get to a designer so that you can design whatever you needed to moving forward.
So is it, will it be planted with grass or fence around it?
Yeah, so typically they They typically will grade it just foot dry over just to keep it from a lot of dust getting more. So that would be part of the specifications.
Any other questions on the park? Barry, I mean, I'm sorry, the demo. Barry.
Barry Gallant. My first question is, now, will this be overseen by the BBCC?
Yes.
Okay. And sometimes in the past, the town failed to put a penalty clause in a contract with a builder or a developer. And for those who don't know what a penalty clause is, if the town and the potential contractor agree on a finished time, and that finished time isn't done, then the contractor pays a certain penalty to the taxpayers. It gets a safeguard to the town. And I know, go ahead, Julia.
We've done it here. We did it with EWI. Yeah, the thing with this is, three to five months project, like three years.
So the difficulty with what you're discussing is liquidated damages, basically. You have to show what damages that you've incurred to be able to collect that. So I've been involved for 37 years, I'm showing my age, but for 37 years I've had liquidated damages for and against projects. I've only been able to collect once, and I'll tell you the reasons behind it. If there was a department that had to rent space for this particular space, and we ended up putting them in a location, and then the contractor was late, we have the ability to go after them for the cost associated with the delay that was happening. You can't just arbitrarily just say you're going to give me $1,500 a day to move forward. The good news about what you're doing here, demo contractors move very fast. Abatement contractors move very fast, and there's two reasons for it. One, the faster they get it done, the more money they're going to make based on their, you know, and under 149, because this is what it's going to be bid under, they're going to have to be required to pay prevailing wage. The quicker they get it done, the less money they have to pay out wages to do so. So normally demolition on a construction project, I would entertain that, especially if some department or a facility is displaced and there's a cost associated with doing that. We had a fire station being built on a local location where a fire station was. We did a temporary location. We ended up incurring costs on there. The contractor was a month behind, $1,500 a day. He ended up having to pay, you know, something towards the town. But on a demo project, we typically don't put liquidated damages.
And as you know, a demolition can impact the neighborhood, the residents, and the business. What safeguards would be in place if, say, if a neighbor or butter, because as you know, this project is in a dense area, not like the old Bomber School. If a homeowner should unfortunately find damage to their abode, you know, relative, is there a, I know like with when they blast, there's a 30-day window, you have to file an insurance claim with, you know, with the, with the town or the contractor in this case. So what advice can you give to the abutters and residents that there is need to protect and safeguard their property, and so that, you know, if an unfortunate, if a claim should happen, and how would they handle that? And plus, if downtown business should suffer any type of loss of business during the demolition, would their insurance company file a claim with the contractor or the town?
So you asked three questions. I'm going to answer them all independently. We'll be monitoring that process as we move forward. Existing condition surveys are typically done on buildings that if you were going to do some blasting, we did it with this fire station. We had some ledge here. And all of the abutters, we actually did a existing survey video of their existing conditions. And then if they incurred something, they have up to, I believe it's 30 days after the fact, to put in their claim. That claim would go directly to the contractor at that time, not necessarily to the town. Loss of wages for businesses, the only way I could see that happening is if there was a, you know, some type of traffic issue with the trucks going. Once they start the demo, there's going to be trucks leaving and coming from the site. The reason for the logistics plan that we would put together so that we could inform all of the residents, the businesses within the area, and come up with a detailed plan with the police and fire to determine their means of egress and exit out of the site.
So there will be a comprehensive traffic plan because, you know, in the morning time, that gets pretty busy with all the schools, and then when the schools get out. And so so there will be a comprehensive traffic plan and potentially police details and that area would be open up to the residents?
We would make sure that's all part of the specifications, and typically the logistics plan is a requirement from day one, because I want to know what their intent is. And we have a baseline schedule for whatever timeline they think it's going to be. We also get a 3-week look at it, so it'll tell me every 3 weeks what their plans are, so that we can logistically meet with the fire department, police department, and the town to discuss those actions.
And just to reaffirm, the area will be hydro-seeded and final grade, and our DPW will not have to get involved with that?
They should not have to get involved with that.
Okay, and...
I mean, you only get 5 questions a night, you know.
Okay.
Okay, God, I'm okay.
All right.
There's other people I want to ask questions, so move on.
I was just going to ask if the existing playground that's there is also part of the demolition, or is that...
So I'm going to have some slides on that. Ideally, what I'd like to do is take that equipment and put it over at the top lot. The top lot, I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes at Pledger Street. We've had to remove equipment over there because it's being dangerous.
And the rest of it's actually going to be, the Parks and Recs department actually just reached out. We're going to be removing the rest of that playground, except for the swings over this winter. It's unusable now. So in a perfect world, we could get someone to get this playground and put it over to that site, but because as of a couple months from now, there won't be a playground there, except for a couple of swings.
Any more questions in terms of how we got here or demo? Well, this guy has his hand up a few minutes.
Yeah, Mike Bangham. I was wondering, knowing that the local residents were opposed to such a high density development proposal, was there ever consideration put out an RFP where it was saying the town would own the demo cost, therefore a developer would have to build such a high density housing?
No, because I didn't have approval for demo. I'm here now. So that is an option after this. People approve demo and are willing to spend the money to demo, I could advertise again if people want me to, if the Board of Selectmen directs me to. But we didn't do it then. I can't advertise something and say, hey, what would you do if the town built it? They spend all that money, hiring their staff, put together a proposal, they submit it, and then they go to town meeting and get demo money and it fails. I mean, it's just not how the process usually works.
What happens if the demo is approved and the playground is not?
That's a great question. I'm going to get to that at the end, though. So hold on. Any other questions in terms of how we got here?
Yeah, just a quick question. Start to finish, what timeline are we talking about in terms of
I got a slide on that.
The overall project.
Timeline to get it done?
Yeah, start to finish.
For the demo?
Yeah.
So I got a slide on there, but real quickly, the demo, if it was approved and we were going to move forward with the demo, we would put together an RFP and hire an owner's project manager right away. But again, I have to advertise in Central Register and these other places, so it's going to take... It's called 60, once I draft it, get approval, blah, 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 advertise it 60 days, people submit, then the building committee has to review, decide on who they're gonna hire, and then at that point, then we start putting together specs for asbestos removal, abatement, da, da, da. Once all that's done, and then we advertise for construction, I gotta go through Central Register, another 60 days to advertise, people submit, us to review bids, make sure they're complete. So I would say, I estimated that when we're done and they have the seed down, would be December next year, so about a year.
And again, the time span from start to finish, once all the approvals are in place, do you have an estimate?
So the demo, I can tell you, I've done successful demo projects could be done in 60 days if they're really efficient. I've seen it go up to 90 days, but they're pretty quick. The abatement portion of it is the more difficult portion of it. So once the abatement's done, the demo goes relatively quick.
Any more questions on how we got here? Was that useful? I mean, should I show that town meeting to people? There may be people who are new at town meeting, don't come as useful to show. Like going back to 2017, gentleman says yes, okay. I'll condense it though at town meeting. I'll try to put it. I mean, I'm not gonna have 40 slides at town meeting, I might have 10, but if it makes sense to give some people an idea of, you know, we just didn't say, hey.
In less than 10 minutes.
It depends how many questions Barry has.
I just wanted to add to that, one of the reasons that I personally and some other people had to say no town meeting was there were no protections for the school administration building. It's all part of one lot. And so that needed to be addressed. But also that we weren't voting on that specific plan by that developer. It was fluid and it could change several times. Had we been given a plan, this is the final plan that he's submitting, yes or no, it would have been a different situation.
So two things. One is he it was fluid, he did revise. He revised the plan down based on feedback that he got. But there's also a planning board Conservation Commission, the Building Inspector, those people are in charge, and those people are your peers, that go and they review these types of projects once someone submits an application. There's nobody in their right mind, I work in the private sector, there's nobody in their right mind that's gonna spend $700,000 on design, full design, and get a building permit, and then come to town meeting. It's never gonna happen. That's why we rely on your subdivision regulations, zoning bylaws, the building code, and all the people that we hire, and we have very qualified staff to do that. So, if he went and tried to build 75 units after coming to town meeting in 38, I don't think that would happen. I don't think the planning board would approve that, do you?
Well, he could have gone back to the first one.
Yeah, I don't think so. Plus, I know Kevin, he wouldn't do that. But again, no one's gonna spend $700,000 to take that risk without having the ability to go ahead and do it. Does that make sense? Okay, any questions in terms of how we got here, or the demo? Joe, you're welcome to stay.
No, I enjoy it.
I don't think so. All right, why are we doing a park? So, one of the things that was in the study, remember I showed you those different types of housing with schematics? In addition to that, there was this one area, page 49 of the study, if you wanna look it up, this slide, and there was some narrative to it, where there were community members expressed interest. Community members at the community meeting, other feedback that we got, focus groups, interviews, et cetera, that the existing school should be demolished and replaced with a public park for everyone in the neighborhood to enjoy. And that was just a draft, a schematic of what a park could look like. So why, you know, the want, or I also could have put the don't want. Voters didn't want a 38 unit housing, which is their right. We've got no proposals for commercial. We got no proposals for office. We got no proposals for a business, a restaurant, or anything else. We don't need a new fire station. You're sitting in a brand new one. We don't need a police station. It's in incredible shape. It doesn't get much abuse. We don't need a senior center. We have one. ADA accessible. It's old school, by the way. And et cetera, et cetera. So we don't have a use for that building. We don't have anyone submitting proposals. So what else are we gonna do with this building if it was approved to be demoed, which the town people also have to pay for, I hope it does. Again, a park. Residents at the community meeting that I was at suggested a community park. It would remain town owned if ever needed. It is passive. It's less traffic, less strain on town services, and it'd be a community-wide use, not just for the neighborhood. That's why the park idea has come out, because of the absence of all these things, and because there was a suggestion or demand for this. In addition to that, why are we proposing a recreational park? The need, or what we think we may need, or what people have said they might need. The town has an open space plan and recreation committee. It's made up of members of planning board, conservation, playground and rec, and others. It's a plan that usually gets put out every 7 to 10 years. The reason we do such a plan, the last one was done by Barbara Gaudette in 2002. The reason we do it is because it puts us in line for different ability to apply for grants from the state, most specifically open space grants, to purchase open space. All right, that's the main reason why we do the plan. In addition to that, it's produced by the community. They had, I think, over 18 meetings, public meetings. They did surveys, all these things. This committee worked very hard. They did a presentation to the Board of Selectmen last week. Very well thought put into it. As part of that, there were some survey results that I just wanted to mention. In that draft plan, which is online, so if you go, you see a bar, it says projects and some other things. Right below that, you'll see a list of things in under news, and I think this draft plan is up there. One of the things that was responded to in the survey was over 75% of the people that responded to the survey, and I think it was almost 300 people, which is really a number for a survey. 75% rated the existing playground and recreation facilities as fair to bad. That's not good. Less than 10% indicated they were satisfied with recreational opportunities in town. You could reverse that and say 90% are unsatisfied, right? And then also in that, 68% indicated they would support future allocations of town funds to either enhance or maintain the existing facilities that we have. 63% desired to have more playgrounds, community parks, and children's play areas. At the very back of the plan, they list a series of goals There's going to be an open space plan implementation committee that's in charge of making sure these goals and whoever's responsible for meeting those goals gets done. Goal number three is to expand and improve active and passive recreation facilities. In addition to that, those are just general terms, general responses. There wasn't any language in there about a specific recreational, active, or passive use. But doing some more digging about what this town needs, what it has in terms of active recreation in town, one of the things is there's an upcoming need for public tennis courts. Can anyone tell me where to find the public tennis courts in this town that's open to the public and not privately owned?
Community center?
It's private.
Nowhere.
This town has no tennis courts. But you do have a tennis team, a boys and a girls varsity team. They use the tennis courts by the White Community Center. These courts are going away next year. Community Center applied for funds with the town, put an application in to renovate that site. We're going to help them pay for it with federal relief money from COVID and renovate that into an all-purpose turf field next year. We have to have a contract signed on December 31st, and then they have to spend the money next year. That's happening. So the courts are going away for the boys and girls tennis team. In addition to that, can anyone tell me where the public basketball courts are in town? And you can't say Linwood because we just did that. Where are public basketball courts in town? Where?
Northbridge Center.
It's in the woods.
Exactly.
It's under a clump.
There's one. There's one public court. Has no lines. And it's right in front of the middle school. Right here. See that rim that's hanging? Brian Paulus from our building committee, our selectman, he went over there and slam dunked and ruined it.
What about the new elementary school?
There's one basketball court tucked in that's used by the kids during the day at recess. Can you go there at 12 o'clock and use it?
No.
And then three teenagers go down there and use it?
No.
It's municipal property. It's not public, if you will. That's your one basketball court. Demand for more pickleball. So this is a picture of two pickleball courts that we put up at Linwood Ave. This is a set of lights that we put up there. We took no tax dollars, well, CPA is kind of considered tax dollars. There was $150,000 that went into that project that John Charles over there helped design and oversee. $150,000 CPA money, and the rest was either raised at town meeting with free cash, surplus. No debt exclusion, if you will, went into that project. We built two basketball courts, two pickleball courts, and a four square court. Playground and Rec Committee, I know Mike is here, and we can tell you why we did those. But one of the things that, when I reached out to Mike and I said, how is this going over here? Well, first of all, I remember when we were doing the punch list, there was kids that asked if they could walk through the chain link fence and use the basketball court because they were so excited. We let them. And then my understanding is that the pickleball is so popular, these two, that the Playground and Rec Committee has to create an app for reservations to use those. Because the people are waiting to use those.
On a daily basis.
Daily basis, as a DBW director. Everybody, Google pickleball, pros and cons, I know. But it also is the fastest growing sport. We had discussions today about how it's going to be an Olympic sport someday. It's already an intramural sport at some of your high schools. We have two, and it's in very high demand. The other thing that we want to talk about, I met with Father Thomas about the vacant parking lot next door and what their plans were, and he said he wanted to make use of that area for recreation. What did they do? They put a volleyball court. They have that parking there. Seasonal use. Again, it's active recreation. Adds to the community, the benefit of the community. So a park would make sense in terms of being compatible with that use. We already have a passive park nearby. Memorial Park is only 700 feet away. I mean, and this is only 2.7 acres, I think. So it's not like you're going to have trails all the way through it. There's already a park, huh?
Get the Riverwalk right around the corner.
We do have a Riverwalk, which is a passive trail. Get to that in a second. You'll leave my surprise. And we just bought Castle Hill. The town just spent, I think, 1.3 million, 1.5, I can't remember off the top of my head. A lot of projects going on. Town voters bought that with CPA money, 70 acres, and I know the committee, there's a trails committee in town, and they're up there actively putting in trails. So, I mean, do we really need more passive recreation on this site? And what passive could you actually do on that site? I mean, opinions, sure, but there's also needs in town that need to be addressed sooner than later. In addition to that, someone brought up the playground. This is the tot lot at Pleasant Street. There's some equipment that was torn down, and I know the stairs are not in good shape, but as the DPW director mentioned, that stuff's coming down. I know there's a lot of people in town that don't even know it's there. And this is the equipment that currently is behind the school administration building that, in the perfect world, we take that, relocate it over there. And that's just something of what a new model, a new playground would look like. My kids are older now, but I can tell you I spent a lot of time at playgrounds when they were little, three boys. I know it would be used. All right, so now we're gonna get into the aspects of the project. So just, I'm gonna have John go through in a second. He's gonna call out specifically what's in here. This is the St. Pat's parking. This is where the volleyball court is. This is Church Street parking lot that the town owns. This is, I believe, the Baker residence over here, their house, and then the vacant land in the back. This is the school administration building, parking, Cross Street. There's a couple residents in here. Crothers, the cars over there, and then you get over to Pleasant Street Church. So that's kind of letting you know where we're at. This is north, west. With that, I'm just going to turn over to John. He can tell you what specifically is in here, and then I'll tell you a little bit more about, I told you a little bit about why, but some of the thoughts and process in terms of what we did when we put them in here.
Sure. All right, great. Thank you very much. As Adam noted, this is south facing north, so with tennis courts and basketball courts, we want them in a north-south orientation. So when we looked at these configurations, this was a way to maximize the site and give you as much program while also, you know, developing a park-like setting. So we have three tennis courts on the west, on the south side, three on the north side, accessible walkways around the edges. Really, that's for spectator entrances, and also if you have parents for the school system, if they're going to use these for either coaching or for spectator seating during certain events. Each of these courts also can be striped for pickleball, so you can add the use where you have six tennis courts or you have 12 pickleball courts. The way we do this typically is one tennis court, you can set up two courts on each side and use some temporary netting that's usually brought by the pickleball community. Where you see the number 10, these are just some small three-row bleachers, again, some spectator seating for those events, maybe for high school events or other community events. Just along Cross Street, we're looking at a playground on this side and a basketball court on this side. We determined that really those uses are unique and available on the street side. You want good visibility with the kids at the playground, especially with basketball as well. Keeping that noise, which is a little bit more noisy than the tennis court activity closer to the street. Obviously, everyone knows about pickleball and noise it's generated, so we can certainly, you know, talk about that a little bit as well. The general grades of the site, this is the high end of the site. Everything generally grades down this way. So small retaining wall, the grade actually drops down at the residential property, so that this is sunk in a little bit to help with some of that noise mitigation. Currently in the plan, we're looking to provide some lighting, so we can talk about that a little bit. Obviously, if there is lighting here, similar to probably how you use Linwood, you know, if there's activity there, we're using it, we'll be turned off at a reasonable hour, you know, per your town bylaws. And then we do have number four, a proposed a building there, really for some restrooms, some storage of equipment. Since there are utilities there for the school right now, it's a good use of reusing those utilities. And obviously, if you're going to have some good activity here, having at least two restrooms, whether they're unisex or one for male, one for female, makes a lot of sense. As it relates to parking, we were able to configure, get about 11 new parallel parking spaces along Cross Street, and then providing a connection up to the Church Street parking lot as well. So we could have some handicap parking, making a connection that I believe is sort of there right now, but making that an ADA connection. So we're still promoting parking back there, along with a little bit of parking along Cross Street. And again, with the proposed design, full ADA accessibility, and then doing our best to, you know, provide some screening. Obviously, we have some residential neighbors here, so provide some planting and screening over here, but keeping the views a little bit more open, again, from a police standpoint, from a, you know, circulation and security.
One of the questions I've had, or a statement I've heard, is like, why do we have 6 tennis courts? Why not 3? Why not 4? Why not 2? Well, one, again, we have a boys varsity and a girls varsity team. There are no public tennis courts in town, and the only courts are going away. Boys will practice here, girls will practice here, or vice versa, after school. And when you have meets, there's usually 5 matches going on at one time. That's first singles, second singles, third singles, first doubles, and second doubles. So if you had a meet and Westboro was in town or Grafton, you'd have 5 matches going on, and then you'd have kids that are on the tennis team that aren't, you know, on that one of the top 5 teams or 5 places that would talk scrimmage there. That's why we have 6 for practices and for meets. One of the things I want to do is go into some of the specifics. Well, I'm going to talk about benefits first, and then I'm going to talk about impacts and things that we try to do in that design to try and limit impacts to the neighborhood. But again, why are we doing a recreational park? The benefits, one of the things it does is it satisfies the needs expressed in the open space plan for more active recreation. There's nothing in there that says specifically about pickleball. Would you like pickleball, yes or no? But active, we know, basketball, tennis, those are all active. It addresses the absence of the public tennis courts for NPS, open public schools, provides a modern, updated, lighted replacement public basketball court, addresses the demand for pickleball, what I mentioned. We can improve the playground facilities of both spaces. We're compatible with the recreation, active recreation is being provided by St. Pat's right next door. There's a circulating walking path, as John mentioned, so people can walk through that area while their kids are playing or to watch. We'll have modern permanent restroom facilities right now because we didn't build any, we didn't have the money for it. We have 2 porta potties up at Linwood for those 2 courts, 2 pickleball plus the softball. Benches, landscaping, monuments. There's an abundance of public parking. We own the Church Street parking lot. We have parking on the street, and we have a tentative agreement with St. Pat's to use that strip of parking. Safety. Some people ask about safety. Obviously, lighting is important at night. Signage is important in terms of what's allowed there, what's not, and then security. We currently have electric. There's going to be electric here. And there's also cable. We have the ability to provide cameras. We have cameras, don't tell anyone, at Linwood for safety and protection. And obviously, it's in a dense area. There's a lot of traffic by there. We put the basketball courts up front. It's centrally located. Another positive or benefit reason for these courts. As a former town planner, I encourage you to look up walkable, livable communities. Anyone will tell you that this site is completely ideal for this type of use. It's centrally located. There's sidewalks to and from it. It's near downtown businesses. Kids play basketball after school, they go to Subway. Nearby schools, how many kids walk down Linwood Ave? I know the Morses, you live on Linwood Ave. How many kids walk down from the middle school going back towards Memorial Park? And that would stop here and play. I grew up in a very, very rural town and we didn't have something like this. And I think it's certainly something that would be well used. It's, again, ideally located. Linwood, technically, I think if we were starting from scratch, we probably wouldn't just go out and build 2 basketball courts in the far southeast corner of town, but we renovated the ones that were there. It's near the Mumford Riverwalk, so you could walk down Cross Street over here, cross over where Carthers is, walk down towards the middle school, and there's the Riverwalk. We are spending money, again, another Barbara Gaudette project, God bless her, to create a walkway through the woods and get the people off of Linwood Ave, because right now part of that walkway, people come out where the orange barriers are and the parking where the teachers park, and then go back into the woods. This would allow them to stay in the woods the whole way, and that starts under construction.
Started 2 days ago.
2 days ago. All right, nearby residential neighborhood access. So obviously there's an impact to the neighborhood. Some may say good, some may say bad. That's not for me to decide. But at the end of the day, when you're building parks and recreation activities and having the ability for people, kids, adults, there's a over 55 complex that's only a mile away. This is an all age activity site. It's for the whole community. It's not just tennis for the tennis team. Everybody can use it. It's good for playground. We have playground equipment, so you have kids aged 0 to whatever, and then you have everyone to active adults. Adults and seniors are more active than they've ever been before, taking advantage of the uses that are being proposed. That's why we're doing it, and that's some of the benefits. The benefits to this versus the alternative that was originally proposed to you that you voted no, this project keeps the residential density down. There's zero housing units associated with this project. There's no increase to the residential density downtown. There's less traffic, and I'll get to that. I got some numbers for you. Less traffic than a 38-unit apartment building. That was one of the concerns. These are the two, I think, main concerns at town meeting on why this project failed. Less water and sewer usage. It's town controlled. We talked about how this would be not town controlled, which is a good thing from a town maintenance standpoint. But there is an advantage to owning the site perpetuity, having control over it. In terms of the impacts to the neighborhood, it's the seasonal use. I don't really see people playing tennis on February 1st in 4 inches of snow. Could happen, but probably not. Restricted hours in the morning and at night. We have those at all our parks. And there's a minimal number of residents impacted by this. There are, I'm not going to sugarcoat it, there are residences that abut this. But isn't it, this is a dense area. It's a downtown, centrally located. Some will say this is a perfect site for it. Some will say it's not. Again, that is up to you to decide. I'm just giving you some options and why this option is being presented to you by the Board of Selectmen. So one thing I want to talk about now is impacts. Impacts to the neighborhood, and talk about specific properties. So this is north and south, east and west. Number one, that is the St. Pat's parking lot. So obviously no one lives here. So the northwest, that's the town-owned parking lot behind businesses. Number three, this is the back of, again, Baker's, I think. Their house is here, and this is all vacant. This cannot be built up for another single-family house. So it's going to stay, well, they can do whatever they want with it, the pool or whatever back. But this is their house. This is the school administration building. This is three residences on, this is Carruthers again, over here. And then this is the Morse's, and then a couple other residences, and then you get up to the St. Pat's parking property. So again, it's dense, but it's a lot of public uses. There's commercial uses nearby. There's lots of parking lots. It's not like we're putting this on the middle of, I don't know, some neighborhood on a cul-de-sac. So specifically, I don't know, the Baker's here. So try to address your concerns. And I know you have some, and I would too if I lived there. So one of the concerns is been obviously, how would this impact you as an abutter? I know before when we had public meetings, one of the concerns about the building was the fact that you'd be able to see that building because it was two stories high plus a roof. So you're sitting in your back and they can see you and you can see them, how bad it is. So hopefully this is better than that situation for you. In terms of buffers, this is the existing tree line taken from the volleyball court, St. Pat's. Walk in, this is the Church Street parking lot over here. So there is an existing tree line here. And that's this in this area. And then there is a little bit of an opening here. And then this full area here, this is their car. And then on the other side of that is the house. So there is an existing tree line there, which is great. We're not proposing to take down any of it. In fact, as John mentioned, we're looking to add to it. So there would be a grass strip, concrete walkway, sitting area, fence, outside play area, and then play area. And then so your house is here. So. And again, the playground, I think, is right in here. So we try to be cognizant of the buffer, adding here and adding more trees and not taking anything down that's there now. I'm not going to say there's not going to be noise. It's a park. Right. Well, hopefully this, you see this better than what was proposed before. In addition to that, this is standing at this crosswalk, proposed crosswalk area, looking down this way. That's Carruthers all the way down there, so that's over here. You can see there's existing trees that are here now. In front of the residences here, you can see them on this as well. And these are the ones in front of Morse's property. And then we propose to keep these oaks, maples, whatever's there. In addition to that, what we try to do is push the development back away from this corner. And we have this green grass buffer here. We have the tree line on the school property, your tree line. And we're adding green space, and then, as John mentioned, the first use to the playground. Might be a screaming kid or two every now and then when they fall and hurt their knee. But again, pushing the tennis and the pickleball to the middle of the site, away from the abutters, and providing buffers. As you move down here to the residences over here, we have the grass, trees, planting, landscaping that we would put in front. the restroom area, obviously not very, hopefully not very noisy. And then we're trying to limit the impact to some of the concerns that were brought up at previous meetings. Pros and cons, I'm sure. Traffic, not Kelly Square, but it looks like it. One of the concerns regarding the previous development was traffic. So when that came up, obviously it was density, it was traffic, what types of use could go there. One of the things I looked at, being a planner, was for data, and there's data provided by the Institute of Transportation Engineers. It's a national organization that puts out numbers, multipliers for trip generation. So if you go and someone's building a Walmart next to you and they have a traffic engineer, he stands up there and he says it's gonna be, this much traffic, blah, blah. He's using this manual. So I went to the manual and said, what different types of uses that have been proposed or what we're proposing, what they generate during the PM peak hour. Obviously there's an AM peak hour, but for the PM peak hour, the elementary school, NES, at one time, talking to the school business manager, had up to 300 students, 300 times the multiplier that they use, 48 trips generated during the peak PM hour. Let's call that 3 to 4, 3:15 to 4:15, whatever that is. Kids get out of school to elementary school, they're not getting out at 2, they're getting out at 3. So 48 trips, 48 cars and buses, teachers leaving, parents picking up their kids because they don't want them on the bus anymore. And then they go all through the intersections in that neighborhood. That's what it was before. Recreational community center. People talk about, why don't we put a senior center there, a recreational center? Well, they don't have a line item for senior center, but they do have one for community center. The peak number of trips during the number of trips during the PM peak hour, we'll call that 4 to 5 for senior centers. So I have to ask Kelly Ball, our senior center director, but when everyone's leaving, that's employees, that's people that cater, that's all the visitors. If you go to the senior center, you will see there's 50 cars there in the parking lot. 38 trips during that peak hour are generated, according to these engineers. The 38-unit multifamily apartment, 15 trips. That's 38 units times the multiplier of 0.39. So during peak hour, let's call it 5 to 6, 15 trips generated. A recreational park, the multiplier is 7.41 times the number of full-time employees that are dedicated to this park. I use the max, which would say 1, call 8 trips. We're not gonna have one full-time person on this site 40 hours a week. So it's not gonna happen. But for the sake of being conservative, I included it, 8 trips. That's 1/6 of what was there when there was a school. That's 1/4, 1/5, if you will, lower than a community center. And it's half of what would be there for the multifamily. So this type of use provides the least amount of traffic for this site, other than, let's say, a single family home, right? Obviously, but in terms of uses that I'm comparing to here. Budget. So the budget for this is broken down, this is online, it's broken down into certain sections, these are the items, this is the actual construction improvements, which are estimated at about $3.5 million. Then we have soft costs, we have legal, all this other stuff that goes with it. And then those are in the middle here. We're up to $4 million. We have contingency, we're up to $5 million. And then if this isn't bid out for a year, 2 years because of delay, design, demo, blah, 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 upwards of $5.5 million. So that's the number the Board of Selectmen are bringing to town meeting that will be in the motion for Article 4, and for ballot question 7, 5.5 million. Again, if we don't spend 5.5 million, let's say we spend 5.2, we're only gonna borrow 5.2. I'm gonna show you taxpayer impacts, and that's based on the full amount. That being said, is there any questions on the park? I have John Charwick, who's our landscape architect, resident, if you will, landscape architect. He did the south field, hopefully you've been up there to use it, see it. Linwood basketball courts, I encourage you to go see it, yes.
Liz Baker,
yep.
I'm the immediate abutter, one of. So I just had a few questions. The plantings that you're going to put in along the existing fence line, are they mature plantings?
So concept, actually this is a perfect plan. Yeah, so when we did this budget, this initial design, we put some landscaping budgets in there. We haven't really decided what specific species. I think probably because of your concerns, a mixture of evergreens, I don't like arborvitae personally. But, you know, evergreen, some deciduous, something that's going to give you a good screen. So if this project is approved and we go through design, that's when we really will go through probably working with yourself, other abutters, to really understand some of the, you know, specific plant species we're looking at. And then when it gets to construction, it's also what's available to some of the nurseries. So we want to make sure we are picking the right plants, and then during construction, you know, the contractor will either provide those plantings, or if they have alternatives, we'll talk with the town, the abutters, to make sure that the right things are planted.
Yeah, my question was more for, is, are they going to be tall plantings initially, or things that have to grow, but you kind of answered that.
Yeah. Generally, I mean, you know, deciduous trees, you know, we want to make sure they're big enough that they're not sort of just small whips, we'll call them, you know, that'll take forever to grow. But also, the larger the trees get, the more expensive they get. So there is a balance where you want to get a good mature tree that will grow over time. And we can also talk about the species that grow a little bit quicker than some others that take less time to grow.
Are you also planning on putting in a privacy fence where the existing chain link is? Because there's a section of old chain link that actually, at this point, belongs to the town. So I'm just wondering if you're planning to replace that.
We have talked about it. Those are specifically things that we would talk about, like during construction or part of the permitting process or whatever. I can tell you that for the school, Ballmer School, are there any Ballmer School committee members here? I know there's a few. I won't point you out. But they did do vinyl fences. They did plantings, rock walls, all kinds of stuff. So it's certainly something we can discuss, and obviously we would target you because you're a primary abutter.
You mentioned the lights are going to go off at a certain time at night based upon code in town. So what's that, roughly 10,
11? What do we do at Linwood?
It's
9 o'clock.
The playground, is it going to be ADA friendly?
Yeah. Yes. Yep, so most likely all the equipment, most equipment will have ADA access to it, and then we're thinking the port in place surfacing. So it's not going to be just the mulch from a maintenance standpoint, and then just from an overall ADA standpoint, it's a much better surface for them.
Okay. You talked about potential employees. They're not going to be there overnight, I'm assuming, because it's going to be closed. What are some of the preventative measures that are going to be taken? Because you had mentioned, you know, there have been a couple stabbings in that area. So what's to prevent anybody from kind of roughhousing?
So a couple things. One is I didn't mean, and I apologize if I phrased it that way, that those stabbings occurred because there was this site here, right? So it just made it difficult from a police coordination standpoint to have a vacant building next to it that requires to go search it and spend staff doing that while they could be out searching for, you know, perpetrators, if you will. From a safety standpoint, that's, again, the lighting. Tennis is a very safe sport. I don't envision many people fighting in tennis, although Jimmy Connors could come back, you know. Basketball, you know, again, Northbridge is a safe community. I encourage you to look up on, I think the Globe had this article a couple ways, the safest towns in Massachusetts. Northbridge is up there. It's, I mean, it's very rare that those things happen, and two over the last 3 years, I believe, those incidents that happen in this downtown area. And they're isolated incidents, and it's not something that's happening all the time. That's not to say that something couldn't happen here 20 years from now. There's, you know, something happens here. I have kids I scare every day when they go to school. You know, I never had to do Alice training and hide under a desk and things like that. So these things are happening. They're part of life now, unfortunately, in our society. I would like to think that this is playground use is not encouraging gunfight, and same thing with basketball. Again, the safety, we're going to have safety cameras up there. We have them at Linwood. And again, it's not like you're in the middle. I'd be more concerned about Linwood maybe because it's so far set back. Here, I mean, there's people here working all day. There's the church. There's, you know, weekends. There's funerals. There's weddings. I mean, it's a pretty active area. So that's, again, adds to the safety. The problem about the interior of the building, it's not very active, and that's why it's such a liability for us, a liability for you.
And then my last thing, for the St. Pat's parking lot, I work at St. Pat's.
Yeah, sure.
So on behalf of the church, I know that a discussion hasn't been had yet about the recreational area being able to use that parking strip, but right. The church is definitely open to having that conversation.
Yep.
So thank you for your answers.
Yeah, absolutely. If you have more, our email's on. John.
My question is about noise mitigation as associated with pickleball courts.
Yep.
And I'd be interested in hearing kind of state of the art. We've all read, not certain, but we've all read stories, articles about the insidious noise associated with pickleball, different from tennis, different from normal recreation areas. So what thought has been given to noise mitigation for abutters in this area? How do we go about controlling that?
Yeah, I mean, there's a few things to consider. You know, I play basketball, so I know the sound of basketball. Tennis, everyone knows. Pickleball, it certainly makes noise. I know that's a pretty hot topic. So, you know, it's a little bit of a balance, right? So, you know, I think the landscape screening will certainly help from some of the abutters. Won't do everything, but it helps a little bit. You know, we have used some sound walls on some projects recently to help some of that sound mitigation. But it also depends on, you don't want to stop the sound from going one place and then bouncing and affecting someone else. And visually, it's a little bit tough. You know, wind screening, we've had a little bit of success with that, with the fencing. That goes into a balance of making sure you're not putting walls of, you know, fence around the tennis courts from a visual standpoint. So I think that's probably, you know, there's certain things to consider, and especially with pickleball, that noise is an active noise to consider. So I think, you know, if this project gets approved, I think that those will be some of the things we probably start talking about initially with the community and the abutters around to sort of figure out, you know, what makes some sense, maybe going to some other facilities that have done a good job with it and haven't done a good job with it to sort of see what makes sense for this project.
And again, I think back to you, it may not be something we have to deal with completely 360. You know, we may be talking about this corner because of the residences over here or up in here, but, you know, for a parking lot, it may not make sense there, but certainly a concern, and I know it's worth it.
Barry. Barry Gallant. Do you know who will be maintaining this playground if it is approved?
Yep.
And do you know a rough estimate on how much it will cost to, you know, you talked about liability insurance for the present MES school, $46,000 a year. What would be the, have you got a rough cost on
I don't have an estimate for this, but I can tell you it's probably under $5,000. I mean, it's small for a park like this, mm-hmm. You know.
And who would be maintaining it?
DPW, so the Playground and Recreation Committee would be in charge of oversight of the use of the facility. They'd be in charge of, so they'd come out in the fall and they'd blow the leaves, right. Throw them all into one corner, and then they'd go in there and they'd pick them up or vacuum them up.
Very similar to what goes on in Linwood now. I mean, plus up there we have the softball fields too, but the greenskeeping,
no
is, yeah, the greenskeeping is very small. You know, leaf debris in the fall is the biggest concern, and trash, I mean, that's inevitable, but very minor problem. We haven't had any issues up at the pickleball or the basketball courts to speak of that there's been any problems. So,
I mean, I assumed it was you guys, but I just want to get it in.
Again, those numbers for trap were based on a full-time person being dedicated on this site. Some parks will have that. The city of Boston obviously will have park staff like that. It's just going to be routine maintenance, same as you do at your house. It's going to be spring cleaning up, fall cleaning up, pick up trash, get it out.
Now, if this article should fail, okay, now there's nothing stopping the town to doing another RFP on the project, and it would be more advantageous because contractors wouldn't have to pay for demolition. Would that be?
I got a slide for you, Barry.
Okay.
I know you're going to stay to the end with me.
Okay.
All right. I'm going to watch 11 o'clock news when I get home. Go. Mr. Sosville.
Dick Sosville, Jefferson Avenue. And you back up to the project estimate. Stormwater management. What percentage of the site is currently impervious, and what's it going to be with this project? It appears to me it's a significant increase, but I'm just asking out of curiosity as to how we're going to deal with it.
Let me go to the first slide that shows the. Yeah. So this is the site right now. So impervious area means anything that rain will hit and won't seep through. So that's the building. That's building. That's pavement.
Yeah, that's all pavement over there.
Right. And then in the playground, I guess, you know, semi, this is probably a different multiplier than grass. But so he's asking whether or not this impervious area, if I came up with a square footage amount, is less than or larger than what's being proposed with the park. So let's just call it some number, 10 to 20%. If it is increased, we're required under stormwater regulations, MassDEP, to handle that additional runoff, and we've talked about the low spots in here and making improvements on Cross Street as needed.
My concern, the reason I'm asking it, is because we need to look at the downstream impact of increased water flow.
Yep.
The drainage in that area of town is 120 years old.
Yep.
It's made out of old rectangular blocks of granite. To my knowledge, unless you cleaned it, James,
it's never been cleaned.
It's full of sand and all the other bicycles and who knows what, kids' toys for 100 years. And so the impact of adding even a little bit more water, the potential for some issue with downstream impacts on drainage is a concern. Mm-hmm. Not lately, but I've been down there, and I know what it looks like in there.
So Jamie and I have been out there. Whether this project happens or not, Jamie and I are using Chapter 90 money, that's money that comes from the state, to hire an engineer to look at this section, because we've had a lot of discussions with the Pleasant Street Church regarding the overflow and the pros and cons about all the water that comes off of Hill Street,
Spring Street,
and there's an open,
it comes all down
ditch,
here.
You can see the open ditch right up there. It comes from that parking area that then goes underground, right there, right by your finger.
Yep.
Just to the right of it. See that?
Yep.
That's an open ditch.
Yep.
And that enters into this granite storm drain system that ends up in the Mumford River somewhere along the way.
So whether this project happens or not, we know we have to address this. The good thing about it is we can address some of it while we're doing the project. While sitting there now, we're not going to do anything with the site itself.
I understand.
But if we opened up this site to a construction activity, that gives us the ability to handle the runoff on the site and anything going around it. Yes.
Marlene Dorries, St. James Court. I'm a semi-abutter. I live on the other side of the Bakers, behind the Methodist Church.
Go on, Dave.
Correct.
Yep.
I would like to know what that little gray building is.
This building?
Nope. Up, yep.
Okay, that's parking. So the town currently owns this parking lot area behind Church Street, all the buildings on Church Street on the south side. The majority of it. There are some areas that are easements only or owned. But we maintain it, we plow it, we clean it, we do all that, we clean out the catch basins. Been out there myself and seen it. Opened up catch basins with Jamie, looked at them, seen where the pipes are, what size, all that kind of stuff. These are proposed to be handicap accessible parking spots. So this is, again, right now there's existing walkways through here. I walk downtown all the time. And then I walk through here, and I actually walk through here and go to Crothers. But there's some access in here now, and then this would be access that would allow us to put a couple of handicap accessible parking spots, because there are none here, and we don't know the site anyway, and you don't typically see them on a street. Like if you go downtown, Church Street, there's no handicap parking accessible spaces. There's handicap accessible ramps on sidewalks, but not spaces. This would allow us to have a couple.
Okay, next question, where are the lights?
So lights are typically, if I had Linwood, I think it's four?
Yeah,
generally in the corners like this?
Yeah, so generally speaking, for the tennis courts, you know, we have two in these corners, two in these corners, and then depending on if we were to light down here, there may be one additional one, so we're keeping all the light on the site and not spilling or glaring off site.
So one of the things that's done with lighting these days is a lot of technology out now, right, with LED lighting. And in addition to that, one of the things that has been a hot topic for years in the planning world is using cutoffs. Cutoff means that if you had the light was cut off in such a way that it only projected down and then this way, so nothing would go on the abutting property.
Right. So it wouldn't go into the Baker's property?
Correct.
Or?
It's not saying they can't see light, but it's not going to be like shining on there.
And when does it go on and off?
So we have timers right now, Linwood? Timers. 9 o'clock. At 9 o'clock.
And they can be overridden.
And they can be, you can walk up and if you have a special key, they can't even shut them off.
And what about security? You mentioned security?
Yeah, we have cameras at Linwood. I'm not going to tell you where they are, but we have them. And we do the same thing.
And what would the hours of use be in the park?
I mean, what's typical? I mean, 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. You know, about playground, I can tell you, I used to go to coffee and had to sit at the playground and have play dates with my kids and other families, other parents. So I expect a Saturday morning, 8 o'clock, when your kids get up and they're screaming and go to the playground.
And for the part of the parking lot that the town already owns,
This right here?
Correct.
Yep.
How are you gonna manage if people decide they're gonna go and do gravel rousing there? We already have it. I mean, I see people coming into the dumpsters every once in a while, people doing spin-outs in the parking lot, and loud music till 11 o'clock at night, and it's like...
All I can say is, if there's an incident that you feel is a violation of law, you call the police department, okay? All I can say is that those things are gonna happen in the area in which you live. It's not gonna happen on a cul-de-sac way out on Kelly Road or something. You're not gonna have people burning out parking lots because there aren't any there, you know? I mean, it's the pros and cons of living in a dense neighborhood. You can walk to church, you can walk to town hall, but you're gonna have more traffic. You know, all those things are gonna happen in the area in that you live. And I, like I said, we have a great police department here. They're great for the community. Anything comes up, burnouts like that, past midnight, call them up, they'll be out there. This guy's 24/7 in this town. He's very lucky in this town if you don't. I know questions, sir.
Yeah, Don Metcalf. Janitorial services.
Yep.
Restrooms.
Okay.
Public restroom.
We have a custodian that does, we have staff that does our town hall.
Locked at night? Is it gonna be locked up at night?
Yes.
See, you know, very quickly, that building can be vandalized.
Yep.
All right, great.
That's up for you. There'll be a camera there. Yeah. Outside.
Somewhere
else. Outside.
Just
someone
else, that's
fine.
I just have a question on Cross Street. What type of barrier or fencing, in addition to the planted trees and bushes, will be put around the playground on the Cross Street side in particular?
Yep.
And around the basketball court?
Yep.
Concern is thinking of little children on the playground, if there's just bushes and trees on one side, nothing on the sidewalk side, and 11 spots for parking cars, I can see little kids, just knowing the nature of little children, running out, or balls going out into the street, slamming on their brakes.
Yeah, we agree with you. There will be barrier around this, access into it, and I mean, you're looking up at how high, right?
Yeah, so four foot high, probably wooden guardrails. Again, for the playground, we want to make sure the kids aren't just getting out of there. So probably 4 foot high, and then around the basketball court, I think it's a combination of 4 and 10 feet. I think the 10 feet might be across street, again, just to keep balls from getting on the street.
And we can adjust, again, this isn't a permanent design, this is just a scope, or a scheme, if you will. But yeah, we 100% would plan on putting a barrier around there. I agree with you. My middle one would get out of the car and just go. So question, someone had? Sir.
Yeah, Howard DeVries for St. James Court. Was there any study done on the impact of property values with something like this?
Nope. I don't think it's something we would do. It's, I mean, property value, I mean, whether it go up or down. There may be some literature out there if you Googled it, you know, again. Again, for us, I mean, as a town, and I have a clean slate, where am I going to put a park? It's going to be in an area. Unfortunately, there's a couple residences around there, but it's not smack dab in the middle of 100 residences. There's a few that are direct abutters. I mean, that's kind of an ideal location for us. Whether you decide it's not and vote no, that's your purview. But for us, again, there's not, you know, it's ideally, I talk about all the different. All the different uses that are around there. I mean, it's dense, but there's parking lots, there's school buildings, there's businesses. So, not sugarcoating, there are people who live directly abut it, and they're gonna be impacted no matter what we put here, they're gonna be impacted. So, it'll be up to them to decide if this is a positive impact or not. Yep.
Just another question.
Is
there if this passes and it gets put in and the town decides for whatever reason they don't like it, are we stuck with Article 97 of Mass General Law where we can't ever get rid of it again?
Article 97 is a great question. I got feedback from someone about Article 97. Article 97, you've never heard of it. It's usually tied to conservation restrictions. So Castle Hill Farm is probably the perfect example that I can think of, is that we buy this land, it's 70 acres, we go into it, we design it to be passive, we put up trails, we have a conservation restriction on it that prevents development. It's protected by third party. Other people are monitoring it, not just the town, to make sure everything's being restricted is being restricted. And then 50 years from now, say they want to build a new school there. Can they do it? The answer is only one way. Legislature of Massachusetts can overturn Article 97.
So the state
can. State can. Through a legislative act. Doesn't happen very often.
Would that be for anything if we decided we don't like it?
It depends on, there's a couple different issues related to Article 97. One, I know federal funding, so if money came from HUD or somewhere else, I think that's a trigger. And I think the conservation easement restriction is a trigger. If it's just a town park, I don't know. I'm not an expert on it, but I can find out for town meeting. We'll have town council there, but I do know that you can overturn Article 97 by legislative vote.
Is it difficult? And will we be using federal funds?
There will be no federal funds. I'm going to talk about funding in a second, but no federal funds.
And is it difficult to change it if we decide to do it?
I mean, it's rare. I don't know. Most towns, when they do it, their full intent is to keep it in that particular use. It's not to say that, 100 years from now, people decide it's pickleball's not popular. Basketball schools. Any questions before I move on to budget and funding? Sir?
Mike Bangman. So, just looking at this project, roughly 85% of it, I'm going to say, is going to benefit, we'll say, high school students and up. The tennis courts mostly benefiting maybe 22 to 25 students at the high school. There's a huge need for young families to have access to playgrounds in this town. I have a daughter who's six. We go out of town to go to playgrounds. So does the town feel that that one little 15% or less of the project, that playground, is that adequate to meet the needs of all the young families, families with young children in town, which is probably outnumbers the high school students that would benefit from tennis courts?
What I'd say is if we could do more playgrounds, we would. I know the open space plan was a general consensus that we need more. So this is, it's replacing another one. But the playground and recreation chairman is sitting behind you. Mr. Dempsey, do you feel that there is a need, and people giving you feedback that there's a need, and in your capital plan that you plan on giving me in February, will there be a request for additional playgrounds elsewhere in town?
Yes, I will.
There you go. So again, this is going to, here's a couple things, but another positive. This is going to provide, this addresses some of the needs in town, not all. It's a 2.7 acre site. We can't do everything here that we could. I know. Anyone been to the town of Barnstable? And they got the rotary is where the new fire station is. And they have a community center, senior center, and an ice rink inside. I love it. My kids play hockey, I love it. I mean, so you can't do everything, that you would like to do, a pool. At high school, a town I live in, I wish they had a rink, but they had a pool. A pool, town pool. I mean, I was in Long Island, and I was at a town next to a high school. And they had a rink inside the high school, and right next to it, they had a park, and they had lifeguards, and everyone was there. I mean, there's a lot of needs in town. Here's what I can tell you. This is what we can fit on this site, in this location, at this time, for this cost. And I told you in the open space plan, they talked about the needs for this kind of stuff. If you choose not to do this, I can tell you, there's not another piece of property like this anywhere in town that the town owns to address the needs that are being addressed here. If you can tell me there is, show me, we'll take a look at it. I'd like to do it there too, because it's only on one side of town. But if this project is not done, and you decide 10 years from now, 20 years from now, to find somewhere else to build six courts, a playground, and a basketball court, it's not going to cost you $5 million. This fire station costs $23 million. If when we first started, I know Charlie and Gomez, when you first looked at this, what, 1980?
$2.5 million.
Yeah, $2.5 million. So almost. Whatever percent that is. 1,000%, right? 1,000%. 1,000% this cost. So the need is not going to go, if we don't do this, that doesn't mean the need goes away. It just means either A, whatever reason you vote, it's personal to you, but the open space plan implementation committee still has the needs. The school still has needs for courts. We still have a high demand for use. So those don't go away. And if you go to do them someday in the future, you got to find a piece of land, you might have to buy it, and then it's going to cost a lot more than what we're proposing to do. This is the cheapest this project for this use at this time will ever cost you right now. Question?
Yeah, so kind of just to clarify, so there is no, Doug Brewery, yeah. Carpenter Road, just to clarify, because
questions on the park and before I move into funding, sir?
Mike Bangma. So what the useful life of a tennis court is, what, 15 to 20 years?
Well, depending on the surface, right? So I think in the budget right now, we're looking at post-tension concrete, which generally has at least a 25-year warranty with it. Anyone that's in construction knows anything about asphalt, knows the quality of asphalt has gone down dramatically over the last 5-10 years. A lot of courts that we've done in asphalt failed pretty quick. So we're looking at making these post-tension concrete, which is essentially the type of concrete you would see in a parking garage where the cabling is. And the reason we're doing that is because the lifespan is going to be for at least 25 years of warranty. We think much longer than that. So, you know, as it relates to the surfacing, from a maintenance standpoint, you're probably going to resurface these courts every 5 to 7 years. And then same with the playground surfacing, that should last you about 25 years or so. So there's certainly maintenance within that. But the lifespan of what we're looking for the courts themselves could be, you know, well outside of 25 years.
Okay. Final question. We can have more time for questions at the end, but I want to move into the budget stuff. Because it's a concern, and rightfully so. So, ways to pay for the project. I think you asked about federal funds, ways to pay for the project. So, we're talking about demolition upwards of $2.5 million, hopefully less than that, and the park $5.5 million, hopefully less than that, for a total of $8 million. So, how else can we pay for it besides asking you to do a debt exclusion? Well, there are other ways. One way, CPA funds. So Barry Glant has emailed me, he's asking, can we use a portion of our current CPA funds towards this project? CPA stands for the Community Preservation Act. The town of Northbridge, through a ballot question, adopted the CPA funds, which had the option anywhere from 1%, 2%, or 3% to add a surcharge to your taxes for a certain purposes, that's historic preservation, recreation, that's open space, housing, am I forgetting one? That's it, right? So there are certain requirements when you adopt this and you collect money. Right now we collect about $244,000 a year from taxpayers through the CPA. And it creates an additional fund for us for those specific uses. And the reason is because towns usually don't, you know, do those things. So there are needs that every town has. So it provides an option. We get about $244,000 a year. Right now, I think we're spending about $125,000 a year to pay for the debt for Castle Hill Farm, and that was approved last year. So that leaves a little bit over 100 grand left. The requirements are, with CPA, is that you spend at least 10% on each one of those four. So it's not like you take that other 90 and spend it on just one of them. You have to put certain amounts of money in a bucket every year, which we do. In addition to that, we have admin costs, legal costs, staff costs that all come out of that. So at the end of the day, using quick numbers, that would leave about $20,000 to $30,000 that you could use towards the debt of this project. It wouldn't probably do that because let's just say you need to put money somewhere else and to another field, another housing preservation project, or historic preservation project, like the school building. Like the Arthur Fletcher. So one of the ways is CPA. So could we do it within the existing funds that we have? Probably not. But the town could, if you want, convince your board of selectmen to go back to the ballot and increase the percent to the maximum 3%. If you did that, 3 times 244 is 732, and now you have a pool of monies that could help offset the demo and the recreation, because it's a recreation activity all together, right? So that's one way to pay for it. It's not enough, but it's one way. You couldn't just do the demo with it. You have to do the park, right? Grants. Question is, are there grants for this? Well, it's not really grants for demo. It's not really grants for old school buildings that towns own and their old liabilities and problems, and the state comes in and rescues you. That usually doesn't happen. Recreation, again, the only grants that I can think of off the top of my head are passive recreation, and that's through the open space plan requirement. I forget what fund it is, maybe the Department of Agriculture, I forget. There's a state agency that gives grants, I think they're up to $500,000 a year for the purchase for open space. This is not that. So there aren't really any grants for demo and rec, but somebody asked, do we do a good job of getting grants? And I said, yes, we do. We're gonna put $800,000 into Linwood Ave, starting? This is in addition to Mumford Riverwalk. We got a $400,000 grant, it's called Complete Streets. We're gonna improve the walkability, the bicycling, and the
ADA accessibility, and all the intersections, some drainage work. We're gonna create a sidewalk where those orange barriers are now across from the field, redo the crosswalks, make a passing lane for the entrance of the Whitesville Christian, try and alleviate some of the traffic there. So this is all in conjunction. Glenwood Ave is gonna be a hot place in the next foreseeable future between the Riverwalk and the Complete Streets project. So all things that are helping that entire section of town right now for accessibility.
So it's an additional piece to the renaissance of that neighborhood. Just the East Street,
yep.
Chapter 90 money mostly. We got $800,000 going to Glenwood Ave starting this fall, finishing in the spring. We applied for a community development block grant, $950,000 we just got, and that's going to Church Ave in Rockdale for another project on the other side of town for infrastructure. It's a heavily traveled road and it's very bad. American Legion, people know where that is. That's only gonna pay for a third of it, so we're gonna apply three times trying to do that project. And the reason we can spend it on that project because it's infrastructure that's being done in a low to moderate income neighborhood. That's the requirement. So we can't spend $900,000, we're gonna apply for the same grant and spend it on demo. Most grants have certain requirements. $750,000, I just got awarded yesterday. It took me three tries. I got $750,000 for the Town Hall Annex project. Town Hall Annex project, there are two initiatives that Governor Healey is pushing. What are they?
Housing.
Housing and?
Child care.
Child care. So we are putting $1 million of federal funds that we received from ARPA, from the federal government, as a part of the recovery from COVID. And this $750,000, and then the community centers putting forth their own funds to renovate the Town Hall Annex building into four classrooms for additional early child care use. They have about 95 people on their waiting list. This is gonna be a topic at town meeting. 95 people on their waiting list. By doing this, it will allow people to go back to work. COVID, 17% of the daycare facilities in Massachusetts closed, never reopened. 17%, that means less, same demand or more demand. Cost is high, so the availability and cost is a problem. This project, again, so I'm very happy for that. But this project was specifically had to be used for certain things, and it was either housing or something else, child care. And obviously, we're not going to turn that building into something, apartment. But I digress. All right.
Is that the Aldridge School?
Yep. So we moved those folks out of there. They're in the wing over here again. 15,000 square feet. It was the best decision I think the town ever did. Take 55 people that work in a 15,000 square foot building that is the least energy efficient, and move them out into 1,000 square feet down here, where all these people work in the fire department, work together. It's just awesome. We use this meeting room, this conference room. Perfect. New grants. Are there any new grants that are coming out? I don't want to ruin the surprise, but there is a grant. It's for housing. New grant. Anyone heard of the MBTA zoning? You read the papers. Town of Milton says Governor Healey, we don't want to do that. We go to town meeting, we reject you, blah, blah, blah. She says, all right, towns that are required to do it, I think there's 178 towns, and those are towns that have train stations or abutting towns, like us. We abut Grafton. We don't have a train station, but we abut a town that does, therefore an MBTA community. Therefore, we are required under new state law from Governor Healey to supply a zoning district in our town that allows multifamily housing units by right. Not by special permit, by right. File a building permit and you get it. We have one district, it's the R5 district. Don't remember exactly what it is off the top of my head, but we do have one. We are therefore compliant. We're one of 33 towns of 178 that comply with MBTA zoning. Because of that, we are now eligible for the MBTA Communities Catalyst Fund. Came out last week. She's gonna set aside $5 million each year for the next 3 years to be used by these 33 towns for three eligible activities that you can apply for. One, acquisition of land or properties. Four,
housing.
Development of shovel-ready projects. Four,
housing.
Infrastructure. You can design, engineer, site prep if you're building housing. So, could we use this money to go towards the demo and improve Cross Street? The answer is yes, if we're going to build housing in its place. That's what the market is telling us. That's went through all that. Economic development consultant specialist tell us that.
The state's
telling us and mandating us.
So if the Fox Hollow thing comes through, would that count? because they're building 160 units up there.
So we've talked about that. But we're not, well, so if you're going to apply for a grant, would you give it to the private developer that's going to do the project anyway? Or would you take it and use it for some town use? Town. So, he wouldn't be doing the project with the number of units he has if he didn't think in his financial performance that it was financially worth it to do. I'm not going to bust my ass, apply for a grant for him so he can get his sewer connection tied and paid by us. We are going to do something else. We have a list of projects in mind. We're going to wait and see what happens here. We have housing authority in town that could use improvements. So, we'll figure that out. That's down the road. But the question is, can we use a grant that's new, any new grants? Are there any new grants out there available that could help pay for this project? The answer is yes, it's one, but only if we do housing. Okay? All right, ready to talk numbers? Because this thing, both projects cost money. So this is for the demolition only. I'm going to put this presentation on the website tomorrow so you can access it. Call me, email me, if you have questions on it. Question my math, it's fine. Kid does it all the time. We can have some back and forth or whatever. But this is a general idea, and I've done this for every project that we've done. We did it for the school project, I did it for the fire station, I did it for LaSalle Field. Similar charts of similar nature. All right, so we're going to assume demolition only. If it is approved, and we do it, and we go and we borrow $2.5 million, the maximum that is allowed at town meeting, what would that cost me as a property owner? Well, this is going to assume a very conservative rate of 5%. The most recent borrowing we did was back in the spring. We did the last portion of the fire station, and we did a borrowing for the school, a band, and the interest rate, I think, was 3.6. So this, again, very conservative numbers, 5%. When you're talking taxes, you're talking property value, so that assumes the values today. It assumes the average home value, which is $456,000. In this chart, I went 100 that way, 100 that way, so if you're close to that or close to that, you can see, and then talks about the current tax rate of 1209. Good news and bad news. Good news is your tax rate is going down. Bad news is your tax rate's going down. It's going to go down at 1145 next month when the assessor comes in. Okay? That's good. But what it means is, obviously, property values are up, all things being equal. So if property values come down, you actually go the other way. And obviously, if you add debt, the number would go up. This assumes 10-year borrowing and impact on the tax rate. So I have $2.5 million divided over 10 years. I have an even principal payment. I have an interest rate, interest payment, which is seller rates based on the amount that's left. Our annual debt service. And the impact on the tax rate of 1209 would range, all things being equal to today, 14 cents to 10 cents on the tax rate to pay for the demo. The average homeowner at a home value of $456,000, that's 56 bucks a year. I'm not going to talk about how much Starbucks coffee that is. There was a comment about that, that's fine. But $56 a year is what the average homeowner would pay, and then 561 over 10 years, and then summarized here. Okay? I think the school. School is like $500 to $700 a year, something like that. $56 the demo. Now, if we did both, that's $8 million. $8 million over 10 years, same interest rate, same value, same tax rate, blah 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 blah. The interest or the impact on the tax rate, I'm not going to go through this in detail, but 46 to 32 cents on top of the 1209, all things being equal. The impact on the house value at $456,000, which is the average, about $180 a year. Over 10 years, it's $1,800, right? And then again, this is either good or bad or indifferent. One of my favorite charts I like to do, all of this is what you are paying now. You all approved those projects. This is what you're paying over the next 5 or so years. The Northbridge tax rate is 1209. I come over to this column, 1209. How do I get to 1209? 1024 is your base levy. And these are the projects you're paying for, which you have previously approved debt exclusions for. You have 55 cents of that 1209 is for the fire station. That's in your rate right now. $1.10 of the 1209 is for the school. That's in your rate right now. The payoff years for those are listed here. And you can see, when you're done paying for them, that debt goes away. So if I look across this column, I'm going from 1209 to 1207 to 1211.89. The reason for that, all things being equal, today's values, today's debt, blah, blah, because debt's going away, your rate goes down. All right, we good with this part? All right. Now, if I added the demo, well, it's not part of tax right now. It's not going to be part of the tax rate next year because we're not going to finish in time or do any construction now. But in the FY26, remember I talked about that 14 cents, 10 cents here? First year, 14 cents. That's right here, the impact. It doesn't go from 1209 to 1223 because 2 cents came off because that project was paid for. So it would go to 1221, and then you keep going forward. DPW project comes off, et cetera. All right? Now, if you did both, your tax rate, 1209, that 46 cents I talked about here, 46 cents down to 32 cents over the life of the loan. 46 cents in the first year is 1267, in addition to these projects that are already approved for. I'm going to kind of expand on that in a second. So you get this, the town's assessor puts this chart together every year. And it's the town of Northbridge as it compares to surrounding communities. And they've been doing this since the beginning of time. Towns like Grafton, Mendon, Upton, Millbury, Uxbridge, Douglas. How do we compare from a tax rate standpoint, an average tax bill, and an average home value? So right now, you have 1209 is your tax rate. You are 11th place out of 11. Since I've been here in 2017, been 11 out of 11. That includes $100 million elementary school, that includes a $23 million fire station, $3 million athletic field, some other stuff, maybe
$1 million DPW.
DPW, yeah. That guy worked on that. 1209. So we've done all of that, and you're still 11 out of 11. However, your average single tax family bill, the average bill is 5520, which is actually 10th out of 11. That's why I have this arrow here to show you your 10th, and the only person or the only town that's below you in terms of average tax bill is Millville. Now, if we add the demo, I said we were going to go up to 1221. If we added 14 cents on the tax rate in that first year, you are still 11th out of 11. 1221 is lower than 1268, and your average tax bill has gone up from 5520 to 5575, and you're still 10th out of 11. That doesn't change. Now, if you did the demo in the park, I said 1267 was going to be your new tax rate because the first year you're going to have a 46 cent impact on your tax rate. 1267, still 11 out of 11. All right? 5785 still puts you 10 out of 11. So if you did either project, you're still, you know, I have people that come in and say, oh, your taxes are so high. I said, yep. I said, here's your list. I said, you know, this is what your region is spending, and this is what the town of Northbridge taxpayers are paying. Is it more than it was 20 years ago? Hell yeah. But you've done a lot, and you've come a long way, and you should be proud of that. It's a great community to live in and work in. My favorite slide. These stats come from the Department of Local Services of the Department of Revenue. So, you know, as towns, we talk about the community's ability to pay, not an individual. Obviously, if you're living on a fixed income of $10,000, this is not for you. You know, obviously, you're in a different situation. But the community as a whole, what is the community's ability to pay based on their income and what based on what they pay in taxes? That's when we talk about ability of a community to pay, not an individual, because there's going to be people higher than that and lower than that. So right now, the community's median income, based on FY25 data by the Department of Revenue, says that our per capita income, that's per person in town, 16,000 to 17,000 people, your per capita income is almost 45,000. That is 168 out of 351 towns. We'll call it right in the middle, just about. 168. Now your taxes, you are 219 So your income is here, and what you're paying is here. In a perfect world, not that everybody sees that, may see this, but your income and what your ability to pay matches what you can afford. You don't want to be the other way, right? You don't want to have an income of 219 and then a tax bill of 168. That's bad. So you're in a good situation, and you're in a very affordable community. If you did this project, and we went back to, what town is 168th in terms of average tax bill? Braintree. Their average tax bill is $6,334. Yours, based on your income, is 5520, significantly less than the 168th town in terms of income. Now, if we did this project, and I come back here, 5785, and you pay that, what place that would move you up from in terms of average tax bill? From 219 to 201. You'd still have 33 towns of ability to pay for things, if you look at it that way. If you paid for the park and the demo. Okay? And you can spin it any way you want. These are the numbers. I'm just telling you what they are. Well, I'm getting down to the end here. Taxpayer impacts. So what are the taxpayer impacts of what was originally proposed that the town of Board of Selectmen brought versus, say, something else after we advertise the RFP, after we do the demo? So in the multifamily housing proposal that was brought to town meeting, the developer was going to pay for the demo at a lower cost than we would because we have prevailing wage. He was going to do 38-unit apartment building, benefits, pros and cons. Valued at $14 million in improvements times $12.09 tax rate, that's $169,000 in new revenue for the town that we could add to our budget. Remember before I was talking about we had $150,000, $160,000? Anytime something like comes to this, new growth, that's a win for us, for those of us that are trying to run departments with staff that we have. We can do more. Now, let's say you guys go and we approve the $2.5 million, and then we advertise the RFP for redevelopment of the site. And let's say because the developer doesn't have to demo the site, he's not going to build an apartment building. We're going to do the least amount of density that I showed you on that feasibility study way back when. It was 48, 72 units, 29 townhomes, 14 duplexes. So let's say we advertise it and they do the least amount of density. And the town likes that because it's not a lot of housing, not a lot of traffic. The unfortunate part is you're paying for the demo. We're going to do 14 unit duplex project. Valued at 550, I think that's what Stonehill's going for, somewhere ballpark, 550, is that right? $7.7 million improvements, tax rate 1209, that's almost $100,000 in new revenue, which is good. The bad is that you're paying that first year $375,000. So that first year, well, that was also this page. 50 plus 125 debt for the demo. So let's say we only do the demo. So we ask, what happens if we just do the demo? This is just the demo. And then we advertise an RFP, and someone comes in with 14 units. That's a net loss on the town taxpayers of $282,000. Because you're paying for the demo, not the developer. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Questions on taxes. I'm going to summarize, and then we'll have final questions. Any questions on taxes? A lot of information to absorb. Apologize.
Barry Gallant, your presentation tonight on the tax, if they vote for that, that's at this moment. 10 years is a long duration of span, and I'm sure, I can cite a few projects that's coming our way, and you were at the FinCom hearing when the school committee came in and said that they were spending their revolver accounts down. And yes, we're getting a grant on the Church Ave project, but that doesn't necessarily mean we're going to continue to get grants. We have the Carpenter Road Causeway project. We have the water rates are going to be going back another the second part in July. And and then there's, like I said, there's who knows what other projects going to come up within that 10-year period. If you can unequivocally say that there's not going to be any more future projects come up in the 10-year period, and that there will be no other cost to the taxpayers, you know, then I can understand where you're coming from. And now, and getting back to the Community Preservation Act, we were sold the Community Preservation Act that would help pay for recreation, housing, historical, and I forget the other one. And even though it may be $30,000 a year, that would help offset the cost, but that would be mute if the article doesn't pass. And so, and then I have an email here from our excellent town accountant, and she's advising me that they have $531,000 in the unallocated fund balance of the CPA account. So, you know, to me, any little bit helps, but again, the article doesn't mandate the Board of Selectmen or yourself to seek CPA funds, and it also doesn't, you know, mandate to seek any state funding. So, you know, as the article stands now, if it passes, there would be no CPA funding unless there's, unless you say at town meeting that you're going to commit to seeking CPA funds. So, I'm just saying that, you know, if $30,000 is available, and if the town accountant says it's $530,000 unallocated fund balance, why not use the $30,000 to help the taxpayers? Right now, the economy is very challenging. We don't know what's coming down the pipe for the taxpayers in 10 years. And yes, our medium income is $44,000, but we're not an affluent town. We wouldn't get almost $22,000 in state local aid if we were a Dover or a Lincoln or a Sherbin. So all these things take into consideration. So, you know, just my concerns are is that there's a lot of unknowns still here, and we don't know what's coming down 10 years. And we have, you know, I think, what, we have 2 years left to pay on the DPW facility. So, you know, that's another thought. And then I'm kind of puzzled myself. I mean, unilaterally, the Board of Selectmen and yourself and FinCom agreed to give $2.3 million of our ARPA funds to the Whiting Community Center. And I know they took $600,000 to re-renovate their gymnasium. So I hopefully that, I mean, they would also let the town residents, or, you know, use that as recreation also. And if you can put your town planning hat back on, that when developments come before the planning board, they can ask the developer to put recreation fields and things in the development.
They have.
So, yeah, so I mean, that's just some thoughts on, you know, how the way I'm going. Plus, we don't, so you're talking $5.5 million for the recreation project, and that we don't know, our excellent formula DPW director brought up, there's unknown costs now with drainage. So, you know, these are all things to be considered. And my understanding is if the article, like you said, if the article
fails, get to a question, Barry.
If the article fails for the recreation, then you could do another RFP. But like you said, we may have to pay a little bit up front, but at least you've got, I don't know, there's a lot of elderly that need housing in the town, but that's just my thoughts.
That's your option. So I only had, based on the direction of the Board of Selectmen, I work for a five-member board. They have to vote 3 out of 5 and ask me to work on certain things and do certain things a certain way. My job is to provide them options, just like I do you with data. So if whatever the options are here, I have on my timeline, November 18th, I think it is the next selectmen's meeting after the ballot, then we'll have some decisions to make. Are we going to advertise an RFP? Maybe we don't have to, because both bodies were approved. I don't know. You know, and then every step, there'll be some kind of decision to make. So the question, I think one question I'd like to hit on was CPA funds. They have about $500,000 in a fund that's set aside. It can be used for housing, recreation, historic preservation, or open space. So the only people that could spend that money is you guys. Someone puts an application in, has to be based on the plan that they approved. They have to then bring it to the town meeting, and then town meeting voters can spend money out of that fund. If you approve both projects, and it's $8 million, and someone wants to put an application in, and I'm pushed to do it by the Board of Selectmen, or I guess town departments can do it, and go to them and say, hey, would you guys bring a project of fund or a funding article to town meeting next May to put $500,000 to this $8 million, and it gets approved? Great.
much money out there for low-income housing and senior housing, why didn't someone consider rehabbing the existing facility into senior housing and getting grants for it?
So there's no, the grants that are available, grants that are available, there's $5 million for 33 towns. Do the math. The project of renovating that building was $20 million in 2017. What's it today? So who's going to spend $30 million less, 1/33rd of $5 million? You guys going to spend $30 million on that site to do low-income housing? If you tell me that's what you want, and to go to the Board of Selectmen, and you come to me and say, We want you to put an article, Board of Selectmen, on town meeting to spend $20 to $30 million to renovate that into 112 affordable housing units, and we'll apply for a grant there, we'll use Chapter 90 to do Cross Street, then I'll do it. I work for you. I work for the Board of Selectmen. So if that's something that interests you, then you need, we need to hear it.
I guess I don't understand, when we voted for the new school, no one ever said to us, and when we build this new school, we're going to have this problem over here. I think I assumed that when I voted for the new school, that it was a plan to do something with the existing building other than crossing
the school. So the plan was to get permission from you guys. We did a feasibility study. What could we do with it? First of all, there was no town use. It outlived its use as a school. We all agree on that. So there's going to be left a building. Then we go through all the different town departments. Is there any use for a town department that's worth us spending $20 to $30 million on a renovating that building? There wasn't. So the only people that could really decide what to do with it, after we do a feasibility study, and after the voters said, bring something to us, we did, the house project was rejected, and now we're here. So there was always a plan, and we knew we had to do something with it, but at the end of the day, you know, we couldn't just put a for sale sign on it. We had to study what could be done, give the community a chance to have their say, bring articles to town meeting, advertise RFP, and that's what we've been doing the last 3 years. So unfortunately, the $100 million that was approved for NES did not include a single penny. It was brought up 100 times, because I went to a lot of meetings, 100 times. Is there any money in the $100 million to demolish NES? And the answer was no. So I have building committee members here.
Charlie Watler, so you're asking the proposals to ask to increase taxes without anybody knowing what's coming down the pike. This gentleman brought that up. What are the projects the Board of Selectmen have on their radar that 2 years, 3 years, 4 years from now, we're going to be sitting in the same room and we're going to hear a message about increasing taxes yet again?
So we
have the two fire station buildings and there's probably other ones. What can you share with the town to say, hey, here's what's coming down the pipe that we know we're going to have to spend money on?
Absolutely. So we do a 5-year capital plan update every year. So we project over 5 years what we're going to need for equipment. That's fire engines, that's sewer treatment plant upgrades, that's new schools, that's curtains on windows, whatever. We do that every year. Every staff department does it, the school does it, the water company does it, we come together, and then we come to town meeting with articles. My predecessor, his way of spending and addressing those items in the capital plan was every year you had a ballot question. I don't know if people remember that. Every year you had a ballot question, and he would ask for a fire truck, two cruisers, a DPW truck, and improvements to the roof at the annex, blah, blah. Every year your taxes would go up. Since I've been here, since 2017, we haven't done any of that. Every single project we've done, we've probably done $15 to $18 million in projects. Linwood, I'm losing my train of thought. But we did that with free cash. So free cash, for everyone who goes to town meeting knows, free cash for the private world is called retained earnings. Any money that's left over on the close of your fiscal year, June 30th, that's any money that departments didn't spend, any new revenue that came in above and beyond what you forecasted, that money is called free cash. So we did, you know, just props off the top. We did $1.5 million boiler improvements at the middle school. We're dealing with Quaker Street landfill right now. We set $1 million last year for that. We bought fire trucks. We bought tons of fire trucks, DPW trucks, all free cash without raising taxes. We're going to continue to do that. As far as what in that capital plan is a bigger project that may require a debt exclusion, the only thing that I can think of off the top of my head, other than the middle school someday, whatever, that's not up for me to decide, that's the school department, is water and sewer upgrades. Most specifically, sewer treatment plant upgrades. So The EPA comes out in 1972 and says, Clean Water Act, yay, we're going to do this. We're going to give you X amount of $1 million. You're going to build a sewer treatment plant. And then they come back 10, 20, 30 years later and say, your requirements are now this, and then you have to do a $10 million improvement. That's what Mr. Sazewell did back in 99, 2000. Yep. So guess what? There's new EPA requirements coming out. Everyone heard of PFAS, right? All these things that are coming out there. So at some point, someday down the road, we're going to apply for a permit, and the EPA is going to require us to make upgrades at the sewer treatment plant. That will be borne by the users under the sewer enterprise fund. So if you're on a septic system, congratulations. But that's the only thing that I can think of. But again, at the end of the day, and you talk about what's coming down the line, I mean, I can only tell you what's here today. We do have an idea of what products are coming down the road. We don't need fire station, police station, senior center, all those things we talked about. But that's not to say EPA could come out with another requirement for something else. We're dealing with Quaker Landfill right now, and we're dealing with our free cash. I just had to prioritize the majority of that going to this project. So right now we're looking at a partner project, Whitesville Water Company, to expand the water line from somewhere on Quaker Street, past Church Street Extension, take a left, from somewhere down there, all the way down past the old landfill, down old Quaker, and down a portion of Menden, to take all the people that have contaminated wells and get them on public water. Because right now we're supplying, I don't know if people know this, I brought it up, but we were supplying water and water filter systems to up to 42 homes that have been contaminated by their testing of their water. So that's something, but I'm gonna pay for that free cash because I can do that, it's a small enough number. 10, 20 million, 30 million dollar projects. The only thing I can think of is the middle school someday. And you know, I don't know what, the school department, if you think about what happened with Ballmer, started 2015 and then moved until 2021. So 2015, they submitted an application, got them on a list, then they got funding for a feasibility study and then all the way to building the school. Anywhere along that way, you could have said no and it could have died, but it didn't. But I don't know. But hopefully that answered the question.
What are the plans for the two fire stations? Are we have to pay for demolition on those?
Nope. Or? So we went to town meeting and got permission from the voters to sell those buildings because it wasn't deemed as important as or as large as this site here. So we have sold the 193 Main Street former headquarters to a company called One Construction. They have to apply for permits. They haven't done it yet, but their plan is to turn it into a multi-use building, combination of offices, antique car storage, and hopefully a restaurant on the bottom floor. We sold that building. We got one bid. Guess how much we sold it for?
$50,000.
Rockdale Fire Station. We sold that to the same company. We had three proposals. They're going to turn that into a, there's a gentleman who's a partner of One Construction. They do antique car engine repair, and they're going to use that for that. Guess how much we sold that for? $66,500. Old buildings aren't worth a lot. So someone says, hey, this is on the assessor's list, says this building's worth $20 million. Yeah. Okay. It's not the market value of it, of the buildings. Market is only as good as what people are willing to pay for it. Someone was only willing to pay $50,000 for the old fire station because he's got to put $2 million into it or more just to make it useful. All right, it's getting late. Talk about that. Questions of taxes. All right, next steps. Next steps, next week at the high school, we moved our town meeting to the high school, Tuesday, October 22nd at 7 p.m. I'll be there, hopefully you will too. And there's seven articles on the warrant. There's the first one is a housekeeping article. There's a preservation restriction on the school administration building. There's a cable advisory committee bill to article to housekeeping. And there's one petition, which is a zoning change. We have a lot of information coming in the packet, or I think you guys get cards now and you go online and get it. Presidential election ballot, November 5th. It's also the state, senators, reps, all them. And then in addition to the five questions you will be asked, in addition to like the servers one, the MCAS one, whatever else is on there, you'll have two ballot questions for the town. Question six is for the demo, question seven is for the park, and then a little bit less than 2 weeks after that, the Board of Selectmen will decide what to do next based on what votes happen. This is the timeline I'm talking about with Joe, that if the demo's approved, so again, town meeting is November 5th, we would start right away, we'd work on an RFP, we'd advertise to hire an OPM. We have to go through a process to do that. The building planning construction committee would be in charge of that, interviewing consultants, hire someone. Whoever they hire would then start putting together the specs and the for the abatement analysis, maintenance study, have that done by the end of spring, let's say, hire a contractor over the summer, and hopefully complete, wrap up, have grass planted for the fall of next year, and we're out of there December 31st, 2025. That's if the demo's approved, and that's just a ballpark timeline. If the park is approved, we work on, I don't know if we have the same OPM, probably not, but we can simultaneously start the design knowing that it's paid for while the demo is all being done. And then obviously we can't start construction until this is done December 31st, have our contractor ready to go, and then start, call it a year to build, ballpark?
Yeah.
All right, so just in summary, why are we demoing NES? Talk about the money and repairs needed, no need for a town building, the cost to maintain, insurance, vandalism, blah, blah, blah. We advertised it twice, we got one proposal, didn't go through, we got no proposals the second time, so now we're stuck with this big, empty, you know what? Why the park? We talked about the open space plan results. People suggesting generally the active recreation would be great. These are certainly some of the things we talked about putting in there. Some of the benefits, walkable, compatible, blah, blah, blah. Impacts of the park. We talked about how it's less on town services. There's no residential density increase, less traffic. Talked about how way back when during the peak hours, there was 48 trips during school hours. And then that's down to 8 or less. We talked about trying to do the best we can to buffers. We can obviously have more conversations about fencing and other things. Talk about being lighted, secure, town maintained, you know, seasonal, it's not 24/7. And we talked about the tax impact and the town's ability to pay. Questions?
I have 1 minute to make a public service announcement.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Thank you. I'm talking to the veterans in town, the veterans that are here. On November 8th, at the Senior Center, there will be a Veterans Breakfast. You are all invited. You need to go by the Senior Center and get a ticket. That's my public services. So come and have breakfast with us at the Senior Center.
Thank you, Mr. Sadler. Just a little feedback. In terms of the presentation, I plan on going from 40 slides to like 10, but is this information good enough? Is there things missing that you'd like to see that you think other people would want to see? There's a lot of information here. Again, it's online. I'll try to have some handouts for town meeting, not everything. But if you're on the fence or you need to, what decision do I make? Is there anything else that could be provided that wasn't provided that may be a good idea that you'd like to see? Is it worth going through this at town meetings? Question?
Yes. Joanne Gallant, no relation.
As a French Canadian,
yes, I am.
Barry and I talked about how we're probably related.
You didn't address the cons of just leaving it land after the demo.
Okay. Cons. So if it doesn't pass and it's left as a vacant lot, I can tell you that I've worked in towns that have had vacant lots before. You know what happens to them? They become dumping grounds. Usually what happens. You're going to see mattresses there. You're going to have homeless people living there. You're going to have cats and dogs and wild animals running through there. To me, as a community, I must speak on behalf of the Board of Selectmen, which they hire me. And one of the things that we talk about is what is in the best interest of the community. If it demos, and then we get a proposal, it's housing or whatever it is, and it gets rejected, and we're left with a vacant lot, is it in the town's, as a whole, best interest to continue to pay $375 down to $325 every year without any income coming from a 2.7-acre site in your downtown? It's not in the financial best interest as a community to not look at what else could we do that from a financial standpoint. And leaving as a park doesn't really do that. I get asked all the time by your cousin Barry, what are you doing in terms of selling town property, and what are you doing with property that the town owns that could be used to bring in income to the community? He asks me every year at the Finance Committee. Am I wrong? No. So
sometimes.
Probably, we can talk about that.
Some properties.
Yeah, but anyway. So again, it's an ideal location for a use. It's up to you guys to decide what uses are on the table, what you'd like to see there, what you don't. But at the end of the day, if this doesn't get approved, we will have to go back to work, which is fine. You know, again, I don't vote. My job is to be completely objective, provide you guys with options, and then you decide up or down. And if it goes down, it goes down. Then I'll be back to work on Wednesday morning, November 6th, and we'll go back to work. So we'll figure something else out, and we'll have another meeting like this down the road. I can't say what would go over there and what we can do. Again, what is the federal government pushing? What is the state pushing? They're pushing housing. I mean, as there are towns that would love a lot like this and then do something with it and get income from it. There are towns that would love to have this and put a park in it. Yeah, could be towns that love to have a brewery, a restaurant, office space. I get it. I can only advertise, and then what the market is. So ideally, I don't think it would stay vacant. We wouldn't look to keep it as a vacant lot. Does that make sense? Do people agree with that? We got to do something with it, right? It's 2.7 acres in the downtown. I mean, you don't sell it now, maybe you sell it 10 years down the road, and Microsoft comes down and puts a 200 person office in. I don't know, but you got to do something with it. So what's your complaint?
Sludge drying base.
All right, so I'll stick around. If anyone has any questions, there'll be a town meeting. Again, we'll put this up on the web. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.